Good morning and welcome to the 33rd meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2022. I've received apologies from David Torrens for today's meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 3 in private today. Are members agreed?
Agreed.
Agreed. Thank you, colleagues. And the next item on our agenda today is further consideration of the National Care Service Scotland Bill, and we've got two evidence panels. And before we start, I just want to thank everyone who took part in our informal evidence sessions last Monday in Aberdeen and yesterday in Dumfries. I think that members who participated in them would all agree that they were extremely helpful, and we'll be making sure that some of the things that we heard in these informal sessions make its way into our scrutiny of the bill and, of course, our questioning of other witnesses and the Minister ultimately. But this first panel today will focus on data and information sharing aspects of the bill. We've got two of our witnesses are appearing remotely, but we've got four in person. So good morning to you all, whether remote or here in person. We have got Darren Fitzhenry, the Scottish Information Commissioner, Paula Fraser, Development Officer for Voices of Experience Scotland, Beth Lawton, Chief Digital and Information Officer for the University of Strathclyde, and Ken MacDonald, the Head of ICO Regions of the Information Commissioner's Office. And joining us online, we've got Scott Held, the Head of Data-Driven Innovation for Public Health Scotland, and Dr Kenneth Meehan, the Head of Information and Data Protection, representing SOLR. So first of all, I'm going to come to David Fitzhenry first, because your office made a late submission, and I think it's as well to maybe ask you about that first. In relation to the provisions in the bill that impact on the Scottish Parliament corporate bodies, independent office holders, and I wonder if I can come to you first of all, just for you to raise your issues with that, so that we can hear what they are.
Yes, thank you for that, convener. It relates to Section 15 and the provisions involved there relating to complaints and the ability to make regulations concerning complaints. And the way in which it's currently drafted, in particular the reference in subsection 5 of Section 15, it's quite an expansive definition of the authorities in relation to which ministers are being given power to make regulations. In essence, it relates to many of the office holders, including myself. Now, and the powers being given are the powers to impose duties by Henry VIII powers, but also powers to remove functions from the bodies themselves. And my concern is that there didn't appear on the face of the legislation or in any of the documents to be a clear rationale as to why the Scottish Minister should have any power to alter the primary legislation relating to my office and my post in relation to this. I know other office holders will have their own views, and in particular the SPSO, but from my perspective there didn't seem to be a clear rationale as to how freedom of information should be affected in relation to complaints. Certainly I would be concerned if there was any desire to remove the function of freedom of information in relation to complaints, the complaints process in this system, when it exists for the complaints processes in other systems. And in the lack of a clear rationale or driver, certainly in the policy memorandum, I think the example given does relates to the SPSO, which is where I think that the focus lies. But that being the case, my concern would be to include, if it's the SPSO that the intent is there to alter the legislation in relation to, then I would suggest that it would be safer for those powers to be restricted to that office holder. And as I say, I know the SPSO will have their views on whether that would be appropriate in and of itself, but certainly in relation to me and my role, to preserve the independence of it and to preserve the application of freedom of information in relation to all aspects of this, I would respectfully ask that the committee have regard to that in determining whether the current definitions are appropriate given the extensive powers potentially available to ministers under it.
I wonder if any colleagues want to come in on any of that or ask anything further? Sandesh?
So can I just be absolutely clear here? You feel that the Information Commission needs to be taken completely out of the bill and should not have been included in the first place?
This is purely in relation to Section 15, which looks at the regulations for the dealing of complaints. And it seemed, on the face of it, I couldn't see why any regulations should require any alteration of the powers, duties, functions of the Scottish Information Commissioner within that. And therefore, in the absence of a clear rationale, it would be my submission that we should be removed, certainly, from the ambit of it. I think there's a wider discussion as to whether it's appropriate for such powers to exist generally in relation to any of the office holder provisions. But certainly, as far as I'm concerned, I don't see any clear applicability or suggestion as to how it may be used in relation to my office.
By that, you mean the Henry VIII powers would basically give you the option of doing anything you want?
Which would give the ministers the ability to change the primary legislation insofar as it related to those complaints processes.
Thank you.
I just want to ask, I mean, during the pandemic, obviously freedom of information was one of the areas in which, in the emergency powers, because of deployment of, I suppose, staff to other areas, that was something in which there was emergency powers. I don't want to ask you to speculate because you're saying you don't know what the rationale is, but do you think that maybe there's something in that relates to this?
I couldn't see it here, to be honest, Convener, because this provision purely relates to the dealing of complaints. It's regulations to make provision about the handling of complaints within that system, so it's bounded by that purpose. And by being bounded by that purpose, I couldn't see what regulations would be relevant to freedom of information, unless there was a desire to remove the ambit of freedom of information from such a system. And I would respectfully submit that should not be done. There are exemptions and exceptions which apply to information if it's inappropriate to release it, and we apply those throughout to many authorities who have complaints procedures.
Well, thank you, and we will make sure that we raise this with the Minister and we get clarity on to your concerns and your questions. Thank you. Right, moving on. Paul, can I hand over to you?
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the panel. And we're going to start questioning this morning, focusing firstly on a single electronic record for health and social care. I think this is an issue that has come up time and again in our scrutiny of the bill, but not only in our scrutiny of the bill, I think more broadly in many of our inquiries and our work about the importance, I think, that many people feel a single record would bring, particularly in terms of people not having to repeat their story or their issues time and again. So I wonder if I can just start by asking about the panel's views of the benefits or otherwise of a single electronic record. And within that, I suppose, is there sufficient data currently in the system to be able to deliver such a record? And, Convener, I'm happy to go to each of the panels, if that's possible. So I don't know if we want to maybe start with Beth Lawton.
Thank you. In terms of benefits, I think undoubtedly there are benefits right the way from the individual citizen up until to a public health level of holding a single health record or being able to access the data from a single place. And I think that's probably key. We don't necessarily need to have one system which holds all the data for everyone, but we need to have a way that data can be collated so there isn't a repetition, as you say, the ability to for a citizen only to have to present the same information once, not go through it every time on their journey through the health and care system. I think from a health population health issue, also from research, to be able to access that information on an individual from the beginning of their journey through the system to the end is really important. And so to have it held in one place. But we do have the beginnings of platforms within Scotland which can allow for that. So, you know, for example, we have the National Digital Platform. So there wouldn't necessarily be a need to start from scratch, but to build on existing. I think if I might also speak to some experience in setting up the integrated care system in Sussex, there is a danger that at the moment all the various entities involved with health and social care, be the NHS, social work within councils or charities, they will all have their own systems. Some of those will be very difficult to unpick from the organisational system to move onto a central platform for everything, because those links would still need to be kept. And so from a sort of digital perspective, my preference, should I be asked, would be more towards building a information aggregation point so that you can extract data from the systems, hold it centrally. As I said, the National Digital Platform might provide a basis for that, but to start building a system from scratch feels a little like the National Programme for IT in NHS England, which is possibly not one we'd want to recommend.
Ken, sorry.
Thanks. I'm here representing the UK Information Commissioner, and our interest is in particularly in data protection, and so there are others that are better qualified to talk about the architecture of these systems. However, anything which improves the service to the individual, to the patient, to the whether it's health or social care, we would support, as long as it's done proportionately, as long as it's done securely, and everything starts off from a perspective of privacy by design and default. In other words, the privacy of the patient or the service receiver is paramount, and the system is built about that. It's a requirement now under the UK GDPR to start off from that premise, and as long as it's developed with the patient in mind, and also that you're interacting with patient representative organisations to get their views on where the dangers are and where the privacy risks are, then we would support the development of it.
Dan?
Yes, again, I come from the perspective of freedom of information, so my key interest is in this area would be more in relation to non-identifiable social care data. But the more accurate records you have, if you have one version of the truth, if you have a consistent system, then that makes it easier to create and hopefully disseminate reliable, non-identifiable health and social care data, which can be used to judge services, improve them, and hold authorities to account. So if the system helps and enables that, then again, that's something which I would certainly not have a negative comment on.
Paula.
Hi. Many of our Voices of Experience members have expressed frustration and anxiety at the repeating of the stories, like you'd mentioned earlier, and are in favour of having a consistent integrated record. But even those that are in favour of that do have concerns about it and about the IT system working properly and about records being consistently recorded by the different services and also about having their own access to their records, which they've found repeatedly really difficult to do and having to ask for it over and over again, maybe sometimes not receiving the information on their own records and they would want to have informed consent for particular parts of the record. But we also had a lot of members who have really deep concerns about any possibility of mental health records in particular being part of this consistent record, because obviously at the moment it's closed, and for many of our members, they are very concerned about the possibility of those mental health records being available to everybody across the NHS and social care. And part of that is obviously to do with the stigma and judgment that many of the members have experienced from staff, and the possibility that data could end up more widely shared. And they really are very worried, and so many of the members are saying, in terms of mental health records being shared, that absolutely shouldn't happen because of those concerns.
We'll go to our colleagues online, Paul. If I go to Scott Hill, first of all.
Convener, so I agree with the other panel members. We definitely see benefits to a national care record. As Beth said, at the kind of public health level, definite advantages there. And also with regards to kind of service planning and how all that is organised. I agree with Beth, and not sure it would be one kind of record or one system, but the ability to bring together data would be really, really important. And I think there is a need to think about kind of the IT infrastructure that lies beneath all of this. Maybe just one thing to say is that Scotland does have lots of experience in record linkage, and that's certainly an area that I think could come to the fore with joining data across the system. Second question about the data, and do we actually have all the data available at the moment? I would argue that it's fragmented at the moment, and particularly in social care, that I'm not convinced that we've got all of the data that we would need at this stage to feed into any national care record. We also need to think about data standards and definitions, so making sure that we're all recording things in a consistent way, so that will be really, really important. And just to touch on secondary uses of data, I think it's really important that bodies like Public Health Scotland are able to kind of access the data held within the national care record, so that we can do the work that we do around kind of population health and service planning. Thank you.
And if I can come to Kenneth Meehan.
Thank you, convener. This is a double-edged sword. Any of the inquiries that have taken place into failures within the social care system have always said that one of the most important things professionals in this field can have is the chronology of a service user's interaction with significant life events. That's one of the most important things from protection of children and vulnerable adults. So clearly having a single record would assist in that chronology. And similarly, picking up a point from the previous panel member, yes, there would be efficiencies in avoiding the tell it to us more than one time. The downside of that is that I think you can't underestimate just how much effort would be involved in doing this. Within my own organisation, we're currently replatforming the primary care system that we use to manage social work service users. Simply replatforming that one system is proving to be a massive project. So if you're looking at integrating all the many, many different systems that are being used across dozens, hundreds probably of agencies, pulling that all together is a massive task. Once you've done it, you're left with a huge, enormous data set, which would require a vast amount of management simply to ensure that the access rights that people have within it are appropriately federated. Picking up the point about access to mental health records, yes, some professionals absolutely would need to have visibility of that. Most of them wouldn't. Even within a single organisation, the level of information that the child protection social worker needs to have access to is totally different from the amount of information that the home carer who's going out to provide home services would need to have access to as well. There is a vast amount of complexity in terms of doing this. And if you look within the health service, where you've had a centralised NHS for 70-something years, you still don't have the single integrated health record. So I think the idea that you'd be able to integrate the social care records, particularly within, I think, the 5-year timescale was indicated in the policy memorandum, I just don't think that's realistic, and I think there are a lot of dangers associated with going down that path.
Thank you, and thank you, Convener. I wonder if we can maybe just pick up from that point that Dr. Meakin makes around the bill itself and what's said in the bill and in the policy memorandum. There's obviously concern has been raised that much of this will be dealt with in secondary legislation and that there isn't clarity in the bill as to what the process will be in terms of gathering this data and then developing that platform, which Dr. Meakin, I think, referred to there about, you know, an enormous amount of data having to be managed. So can I just ask if panellists have concerns about you know, this issue being dealt with in secondary legislation? Beth.
Thank you. I think, yes, I have concerns because obviously when we're talking about building something like an enormous data source, we have to think about what you want to get out of the end of it. And the danger is the way that the bill is written at the moment, the end stage is quite, that's being expressed, is quite high level. So to work out the nuts and bolts of how that would be, so information professionals that I work with would certainly be thinking, what does our end state look like? And then let's work back from that in order to design. And at the moment, there isn't enough detail in the primary legislation to be able to envisage that. So there's an awful lot of unknowns. So I think part of the concern in my area is not that we should or we shouldn't be doing it. It's just that the end state isn't clear enough for us to work out how that might be affected. So it's more of the sense of clarity on the end point being left to secondary legislation that's a concern, not the direction of travel.
Sure. Ken?
Yes, when it comes to developing legislation with processing of personal data included in it, there's a requirement for the ICO, for the UK ICO, to be consulted beforehand. This is under Article 36.4. So for each regulation that ministers are producing, they should be consulting with us, and preferably at least 12 weeks before it comes to being laid in Parliament. So that's so that we get the opportunity to properly scrutinise it from our perspective, from the data protection perspective, work with the officials to see where improvements may be needed. And there's also the requirement to be undertaking data protection impact assessments on processing, which involves this very sensitive type of information, special category information. And if there's any high risks that are identifiable that can't be mitigated, again, we have to be consulted. So there are protections built in during the legislative and the development processes from our perspective to work with the government and the relevant bodies to try and make this as secure a system as possible.
Did you want to come in that specific, because you were signalling to me that you wanted to come in. Paul, would you mind if I bring in Emma?
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. It's just the issue of working back with, so the primary legislation is basically saying that the Scottish ministers may by regulations provide for a scheme that allows information to be shared in order that services can be provided. And so in working back from that, we obviously need to make sure all data secure, and what you're saying, Ken, is about co-design, so that you are part of the process of developing any legislation that goes forward. So I think that's my understanding or trying to get at, is the whole co-designed process that comes from the primary legislation when we start looking at how we're going to manage people's data and then the security of their data as well.
Lawton.
It could be that Beth or Ken,
I suppose it was on Beth's initial point about working back, but I'm happy to bring in Beth and then Ken if you want to come in.
So I'm sorry, I'm a little unclear on your question.
I suppose the question is about the primary legislation will state what we want to achieve and then from that we look at working back towards what the secondary legislation will need to be, and that part of that is about co-design with the people that matter, that know how a co-design process would then take forward. So the co-design part is relating to Ken's comment and the working back is related to yours, Beth.
Yes, so I would absolutely agree with the co-design piece. As I said, it's really important to get an idea of what we're wanting. There will be so many parties who would have an interest in this and would need to be brought on board to make it successful. Because I think as well as building the technical capability, we need to build the culture around information sharing and that both on an organisational level and also build the data literacy. Because I think, again, some of the parties that we'll be looking at are not used to sharing information outside of their organisation. So I think in a way the mechanics will actually be easier than the cultural shift, but the mechanics won't work unless we get that cultural and digital literacy piece.
I mean, in terms of co-design, I mean, our role is very much making sure that it's compliant with the data protection law. And that is working closely. When we have been engaged with the government at the development of these initial high-level proposals, and we would hope to be continuing to engage with them prior to any formal consultation as required under the law. But also in that general co-design area, as I referred to the DPIA, the Data Protection Impact Assessment, it's essential there to be engaging with all stakeholders, whether it's the current service providers, but also the beneficiaries, the patients, the concerns that you've raised, to make sure that they're properly and adequately dealt with in the final formulation of the regulations.
Paul, do you want to? I've got Scott Hill wants to come in. I think I'll bring him in first, and then come back to you, Scott.
Thanks, Convener. Just to build on what Beth and others have been saying, so I think there's a real need to have a sense of clarity on the end point, but then also on the stages to deliver that end point, so kind of working back and thinking through kind of how do we get there. Well, one of the really important points for me is that I think being clear on the data that we're looking to bring into the National Care Record and does it exist at the moment. So I don't think all the data will be there at the moment and we'll need to be worked on to develop that. And I'm particularly thinking through kind of what investment there might be, particularly in local authorities, around investment in IT to kind of capture in a consistent way the data that would be required for this. So I think we've got well-established systems within the health service. I would say it's less mature in local government, so it's definitely work to do there. And then the point I made earlier about data standards and definitions will be really important so that when we're bringing things together across the country, we are being consistent. So I would say it's ambitious. I think we should be excited by the ambition because it's an opportunity to really build on Scotland's data state in a way we've not done before. But I think getting that clarity on the end point and then working back just to kind of understand how realistic it all is will be really, really important. Thanks.
Can I bring in Paula?
Are really for being involved in the co-design stages, but they are very sceptical about how much involvement they'll actually get to have in that and are worried that they won't be represented well enough during the co-design stage. And they were also worried by how fast the bill came in without any co-design elements happening beforehand, in their opinion.
Thank you. Can I bring it back to Paul?
Thanks, Convener. I suppose the follow-on question from that, I think, is realistic timescale. So the bill should be, you know, the National Care Service should exist by the end of the Parliament, I think, is the intention. I think what we've heard there is there are big challenges in terms of being able to deliver this, not least as the data available, you know, what will the infrastructure look like and how will we upskill people? So I suppose this is maybe a two-part question. One, do you think the timescale is realistic for implementation? And two, are there concerns about the cost? Because I just heard that mentioned, and I know we'll come on to questions about finance, but are there concerns about how much this could cost in terms of delivery?
Sorry, it does seem to be me only.
Sorry.
I think it will take a considerable time to see the full value of a system like this. This is not something that goes in overnight. I would think a minimum of 5 years, dependent obviously on the resources available, and finance will come into that. But you should be able to build in an agile fashion, so incrementally, so you wouldn't necessarily go big bang and at the end of five, eight years have a grand unveiling, but that you would be building it incrementally and delivering those benefits in an incremental fashion. I think it will be expensive, and I think that it won't directly release all of that money, but would be the indirect benefits that we would see from having that integrated data structure, that information in order to help us plan, in order for us to take a more proactive approach in managing health. In one of the previous committees, Harry Burns was talking about salutogenesis, the idea of we're creating the right environments for health to flourish. And having that data to hand would enable that and enable us to take a more proactive view of health and care in Scotland, which of itself, because the early intervention and the prevention, would generate savings.
I want to bring it back to the government's other drives and digital strategy with regards to health, because I think we've maybe got into the situation in our discussion this morning is that the National Care Service Bill is the thing that's going to bring forward a sort of like single interface that links records. But in fact, there's an awful lot more going on in government around this. It's not the National Care Service that's prompted this. This is something that the government's been working on for a number of years. And it's something that comes up time and time again in this committee, not just in relation to the National Care Service, but in terms of every aspect of health and care that's having that. I mean, I wonder, I mean, I noticed that Dr. Meehan wants to come in, but I mean, a few of you have actually been in front of us before talking about this in general. Can we maybe put it into that context? I mean, it's not, there is a wider strategy here which wants that interface to work for all health and social care systems, not just as part of this bill.
Yes, and I wonder, with the right architecture, we could actually be talking something more like the citizen data systems in Finland and Estonia, where every citizen has effectively a locker, or secure locker of their own information for them to interact with all government bodies, be it health, be it social care, be it driving licences, banks. They grant access to that information, but it's independently verified. And that could deliver a more holistic benefit for Scotland than having a health and care system in one place. And
there are things in there, so I can imagine that constitutionally it might not be something that can be done. But certain terms in health, this idea of a single, whether you call it a single patient record, which I don't think anyone's really calling it, it's more of a single interface, which gives you access to all the systems that hold all the data in the relevant systems, is not just in this bill. It's a wider strategy as well. Paula, I see you nodding.
Just that our members had mentioned, a bit like the system that you're talking about in Finland, members had mentioned that they would want to have something that's a bit more like a personal data store, that they're able to give consent on certain parts of it, you know, being viewed, but that it's a person-centred, so that they are the ones that have access to that and don't have all of this asking, you know, freedom of information about their own records. So that was really just what I wanted to mention.
And can I bring in Dr. Meehan online?
Thank you, convener. Pardon me. Yeah, the personal data store idea is a good one, but I think we have to be careful, given that we do have regulatory functions here. There are social work interventions that are compulsory. The personal data store concept, I think you have to be very careful when applying it in this particular area. I was actually wanting to respond to the previous point, though, in terms of what's actually in the bill as opposed to the policy memorandum. I think Ken MacDonald mentioned the data protection impact assessment. The data protection impact assessment accompanying the bill only covers the framework, and under the framework, no personal data is exchanged whatsoever. And the data protection impact assessment doesn't tell us anything and doesn't give us any opportunity to engage around the wider privacy debate that I think these proposals should actually be engendering, and they should be engendering at this stage in the development of the plans. You know, we can see that the long-term journey under the framework legislation will be to have the single unified health and social care record of some form, whether that's one great big data bucket or whether it's some form of federated interconnection between different systems, is a debate for another day. But I still think we need to be having a debate early on as to the wider privacy implications of how we do that, so that, picking up Ken's point, the privacy by design can be baked in at the outset and not done as different elements of this. And I appreciate the co-design process will highlight things moving forward. I think we're missing the opportunity just now to have that wider privacy and data protection discussion around the wider proposals, and the data protection impact assessment really doesn't address that. I kind of think it should.
Can I bring in Scott Hill before I hand over to Gillian Mackay for a question on this? Scott?
Yeah. Back to your point about the kind of wider data strategy, and I think an important point is that there's an ambition to kind of modernise how we do things in the health and care system. So, you know, modernise our IT, modernise our ways of working. So I can't comment on the costs around the data aspects of building this national care record. But I think it's important in the context of that, though, we also think about the economies of scale from kind of modernising how we currently do things. So I think that there's a real challenge there, that kind of balance between kind of carrying on doing things the way we're doing it in a kind of clunky, overlapping way, and doing something in a more joined up way will be really, really important. Thanks.
Thank you. And maybe because it's mentioned to broadcasting, that Scott's signal seems to... I certainly can't hear Scott very clearly, so maybe if we can maybe take the video off next time, we might get a clearer... it's better to be able to hear you clearly, Scott. Sandesh, you had a question on this.
Thank you. I'm a NHS GP, and I cannot access the NHS hospital data system. When I was doing psychiatry, as for adult psychiatry, I couldn't access the IT system for the children's, which was the other building. Now, we have significant issues when it comes to accessing information within the NHS, within healthcare. We've been working on this for a very long time and spent an awful lot of money, and we do not have even access to each other's informations. And that's actually a patient safety issue on a lot of occasions. So whilst I absolutely accept that this is very important, that we have shared patient data, if we haven't got that right in the NHS for a long time, what confidence do you have that we're actually going to get anything that talks to each other within the next decade? Because that hasn't happened in healthcare. I was going to start with Beth, but I know Kenneth certainly was in on this as well.
Talking about the National Care Service bill and not this wider aspect, but I mean, because we can always be bringing it back.
Well,
no,
it's very important that, Kamina, it's very important that we understand that we've been working on it in the NHS, in healthcare, for a very long time. So if we want to introduce something new to the National Care Service, which is this shared data, which is basically what we wanted to do in the NHS, but it hasn't happened, in that context, what confidence do you have? I was going to start with Beth, and then if I could, Kenneth certainly was coming in on it.
Okay, so you're right. It is something the NHS struggles. My NHS experience is in England rather than Scotland, by the way, but I think the same premises arise. And there have been an over-reliance, I think, in the NHS on, because of necessity and because it was the only technology that was available, on monolithic systems which purported to do everything and not... share the information. There is a considerable movement happening now, and again, I speak from my NHS England experience, not NHS Scotland experience, for increased interoperability and movement of data between systems, but it's not perfect yet. So the direction of travel is there, but I would agree there is still a long way to go. In terms of this bill and setting up the infrastructure to support the implementation of this bill and the desired way of working as that flows through, I think we would have the opportunity to develop something from a much more a scratch point and build that in from the beginning. So we would look at interoperability, we'd look at fire standards and the like, and build those in from the start rather than trying to retrofit them. So that would give us more of an opportunity. But I don't want to make claims it would be easy. It would be very difficult. There are so many moving parts.
Emma, you have some questions for our panellists. If you can direct them, that would be great.
Yeah.
And panellists, if you want to come in on anything that you've been asked, even if you've not been named by the member. Just signal to me and I'll bring you in.
Thank you. I think maybe my question can be directed directly to Scott Heald. It's kind of on the back of what we're talking about, data and data security, and the public need to be absolutely, I suppose, aware and trust that their data will be managed in a way that doesn't reveal personal information, or especially if we're using it to monitor and collect how the National Care Service is working and how records are exchanged, and so that people don't have to repeat their story over and over. But what do you think needs to be, what do you think needs to take place to have the public trust where their information will be, I suppose, retained, and then only the specifics that are required will be shared? I suppose we could go with Paula in the room and then Scott as
right,
well.
OK, so we'll go to Paula first and then we'll go to Scott. Thank you.
I think there is a lot of distrust from our members about how data is stored and how it is shared, although, like you've said, we have had a lot of members talking about even the current situation, as Sandesh had mentioned, you know, about records not being shared between different services and the trouble that causes. But our members are worried about the confidentiality and the access to their own data as well. I'm not sure what it is that would be the thing that gives them confidence in the system, apart from what they've mentioned in terms of having that access and being able to look at different parts and say, well, I give informed consent to this area being shared with particular services, which would obviously be very complicated to do. But that is what members have been talking about, that kind of idea of the informed consent and really feeling that their human rights are being respected, and especially if it was in regards to mental health records. And some members talking about, you know, for certain areas that they would maybe only have access to bullet points about their mental health record, for example, rather than all of the details. So those are the sort of suggestions, but it's very difficult to say what would actually make members feel that they could trust that was being done securely and that they're that they were confident in the confidentiality of the records.
And then I'll come to Kenneth Meehan.
I think my video's now switched off. I think Bill has been saying there, and I think a key aspect of this will be engagement with public on all this, so people understand data protection is going to be set up and how data is going to be stored. It's a fundamental aspect of any care records. It has to be the information governance framework that kind of underpins it all. It needs to be done at the start, so we're really clear how it's going to work and how it's going to impact. I think it's just the examples that we're given about kind of understanding things from a citizen's perspective, so kind of explain about not needing to the story, and multiple teams will be one kind of benefit to work. But also being really, really clear, kind of, that sensitive data will be handled and how it will be used. The kind of many experience we've got in Scotland, so a body like Public Health Scotland, we do have access to confidential data. We've got really strict kind of frameworks around how that's managed and accessed. It's just something about having that narrative with the public and through groups that have been describing mental health, etc., to understand how it works. We would be having the information governance framework at the start and that kind of engagement with the public so that we're involving people at the start and how all this is going to be set up and managed. Thanks.
Thank you. And Kenneth Meehan wants to come in.
Thank you, convener. A lot of this relates to existing work that we do in the kind of transparency sphere within data protection. I'd say, obviously, most of the players in this area are public authorities, and in GDPR terms, we're told if you're a public authority, consent probably isn't the way to go, simply because there's a power imbalance between the big public authority and the individual service user. So just because you're not using consent as your data protection legal basis doesn't mean you don't be transparent and open upfront with people. Certainly in the local authority sphere, we put a lot of effort into trying to tell people what it is we will be doing with their information in relation to the different interactions that they have with us. That gets complicated because it is a really quite a complicated ecosystem of information sharing out there. I know that there's proposals in the bill to actually facilitate information sharing. I'm not sure to take it a huge step further than where we are at the moment. The public bodies delivering services in this area have identified that they can lawfully share the information with the people they need to share information with. We have those information sharing agreements. We've got information sharing agreements with Public Health Scotland as well. That's the pandemic actually helped accelerate progress in that area. So we already have a lot of this in place at the moment. There is a consultation in relation to social care data, but I think part of the problem with that consultation is that it almost creates an expectation in the minds of people reading that. If a service user reading that consultation paper would probably be left with the feeling that they have more control or should be able to have more control over their data than actually the legal framework gives, or indeed that the ability to deliver services actually requires. I think we have to be careful here as well. Absolutely be transparent, and problem we have in terms of these consultations is that we have no idea at the moment what a national care service is going to look like. So we don't know who's going to be the controller of that data moving forward. And that is one of the fundamental difficulties we have in engaging with this process at this time, is that we're simply, you know, pinning the tail on a donkey, but the donkey hasn't been drawn yet.
Thank you. Emma, did you want to come back in? And then Gillian, I think you have a question on this.
I think Darren might want to come in. It's just to pick up that there are existing processes out there, like Badger Notes for maternity, where women who are pregnant can access their own information. It's real time, and it's their care record for their pregnancy. So there's things that are happening right now, and the clinical portal is another one that's been, it's part of what's being developed, or as a care record, for instance, or access to a care record, in which the patient doesn't necessarily get to see, but the clinicians do. So there is work in process that can be built on about that I'm understanding, is how we can use that as a way to measure how we implement a future, like, safe, secure data care system.
If anyone wants to come in on that.
Yes, thank you. Darren. It was really in relation, we've been discussing the access to the personal data at the moment, but it was something that was mentioned earlier on in relation to getting the data in and exploring issues such as efficiency, numbers, the non-identifiable care data which is coming in. And it's, I think there's an important point to be made about access to that as well when we're looking at trust in a system and how well a system works for everybody, for the public, including patients. And one concern I have with the bill as currently drafted is that while the care boards would be made subject to freedom of information and therefore subject to those duties, the architecture in the bill allows for the contracting out of services, including the contracting out of some services which are currently being dealt with by local authorities. And my concern is that if that is done, and if the freedom of information issue is not considered in relation to the providers of the care as well as the overarching care boards, then there's a real risk that information rights could be lost in relation to access to that non-personal data, in relation to that important non-identifiable social care data. And that was an issue that was, you know, the value of that was seen certainly during the pandemic, when people were hungry for that data to see how care homes were performing, to see how the system was holding up, to see whether loved ones were going to be safe or not. So I don't think we should forget that. And my concern is that as currently drafted, the bill really seems to deal with freedom of information and those access rights as an afterthought to be picked up later by way of Section 5 order, rather than considering it in the body of the bill itself.
Thank you. Gillian.
Convener, and good morning to the panel. Due to the scale of change required, for example, the upgrading of legacy systems, Stirling Council has suggested a phased launch of the information sharing system. Does the panel have concerns about the capacity of some local authorities and potentially NHS as well to be able to complete these in the time frame suggested? And are there any other issues in terms of capacity and workforce available to do this that the panel would like to raise?
Beth. Thank you. I think it is a very real concern. I think that the incremental approach would probably be the most productive one. I think we're all aware that there is, at the moment, a national shortage of qualified and experienced IT staff and sort of colleagues. My colleagues across industry and public sector in Scotland are all reporting the same thing, that there are not enough skilled staff to go around. So that would be a significant problem in terms of both bringing people in for a central project, but also within those various local authorities to not only keep their business as usual activities running, but to undertake significant enhancement. So it is very definitely a concern. But that said, to build incrementally is a much more sustainable way of doing it if your resources are more limited or likely to change over time, because you can move things in terms of what's deliverable in the next sprint, deliver something, pause if need be. So I think the approach being suggested is definitely one worth exploring.
Okay. Scott Held wants to come in on this, and then Kenneth Meehan. If we can bring in Scott.
Terms about capacity to be able to do it, particularly in local authorities. Certain experience of collecting data from social care development has been that it is very fragmented, but I think there are opportunities to kind of think about how we, I guess, modernise the underlying infrastructure as well as bring data into any national care records. So I think, as Beth said, certainly a phased approach. I wonder though if there's opportunities for economies of scale as well, but you know, I imagine there'd be some kind of national team teams as forward, as Ben said, kind of building incrementally in sprints. And further that opportunity then for that national team to work is to provide additional capacity for a period to allow this to happen. But I think the important point there about the kind of underlying IT systems, particularly local authorities vary across the country. There's a lack of consistency, so certainly something will need to be tackled around that. So we kind of crack the national care record whole scale. Thanks.
Can I bring in Kenneth Meehan?
Thank you, convener. I wouldn't underestimate the resource demands involved here, particularly the rest of the public sector. Budgets are increasingly constrained. Vacancies are almost impossible to fill. That's more generally, even without getting into the specific skills shortage that you might find in the IT sector. I think the reality is that even if everybody involved in this decided we wanted to have a big bang, it would end up becoming incremental simply because of the size of the supertanker you're trying to turn around here. There's a lot of moving parts. I think as the co-design develops, we should be remembering to involve the information elements of that as we're going along. But really, this is a huge piece of work. And I think I mentioned earlier, I don't think the 5-year timescale for the information elements of this is realistic. It would be a big ask at normal times. At the moment, as I say, budgets being as constrained as they are and staffing resources becoming increasingly scarce, I simply don't think it would be achievable.
Thank you. Colleagues, we now, I mean, we have touched on GDPR already, but a couple of colleagues wanted to come in on this specifically. Sandesh, you were one. Have you still got questions around that? And then Stephanie, I believe you have some questions. So I'll go to Sandesh first.
Thank you. My question is directed to Kenneth Meehan. SOLA expressed concerns about the impact of the proposed measures on the rights of data subjects. I'm keen if you could maybe expand a little bit upon what you said in your submission, please.
This was particularly in relation to people exercising their subject access rights, using data protection legislation to see what information we hold about them. There are some exemptions to that. You don't have an automatic right to everything that's in your file, and certainly there will also be information, taking the social work file as an example, will almost certainly be information about a lot of other individuals which you probably aren't entitled to see. At the moment, if someone puts a request into a local authority, that social workers who are actually familiar with the case are going through the file and actually identifying the parts where, yes, this should definitely be going out to the person because it's about them, or this is about a third party, but actually I know that the individual service user already knows this, so I don't need to worry about redacting that chunk of it. You know, but it's decisions taken by people who are familiar with the individual. As you centralise the records, if you were to create the huge monolithic data tank of all service users in the care sector, it seems unlikely that those decisions and the interpretation of a request for information would be managed by somebody that has that knowledge of the case, and you would probably end up with a much more bureaucratic application of the rules. There's a similar part in terms of some social work records, particularly people who have been in the care system. There is actually a sensitivity around that information that needs to be handled with care, and very often the way we do it, that would be actually to invite the person in for almost a counselling session. It's not just a case of here's a pile of records and you hand it over and that's it. It is a case of actually taking the person through that, just to make sure that you're not actually causing them harm in the course of them exercising their rights. The further you take the data away from the frontline staff, the harder it is to actually make sure you're getting that balance right.
I think we all of us on the committee and most patients would be keen for the ultimate place to be the patient holds their own data, their own records. I mean, that would be an ideal scenario. But certainly, from what you've said, what safeguards do you think need to be put into place? Because there are lots of things that you spoke about with the movement of this going to a more centralised location. So I was wondering, Ken, if I could ask you that, but also, Ken, if I could ask you the same question about safeguards.
We already have a lot of safeguards, and the GDPR, UK GDPR and Data Protection Act already have a lot of safeguards built in there. This is reinforced by the fact that the organisations dealing with this have been dealing with that level of sensitive information for a long time. I'm not saying mistakes don't happen. We all know that they do and will continue to happen, unfortunately. I think the safeguard there is really to be transparent with people and make sure that it is the right people who have got access to it. I mentioned if you have a huge centralised database, one of the most important safeguards you're going to need there is to make sure that you've got all federated access. You know, just because you can access a system for one reason doesn't mean that you should have access to everything that's in there. You should have access to the information that's relevant to the function that you're carrying out. That is, going back to the resource issue in the previous question, actually managing that level of federated access across the number of staff involved in the care sector. Again, it's a big ask, but if we're going to do it properly and we're going to have privacy by design and default, that needs to be baked into the process. And when we're going through the co-design process, in terms of who is the actual controller of this information, who has access to this information, we need to make sure that's factored in and that we have the appropriate resources to manage that properly.
And Ken McDonald?
I wouldn't disagree with anything that Kenny's actually said on that. It needs to be built in from the start. We do have to make sure that the staff dealing with the subject access requests understand the individual, understand the relationships, understand the dangers that there can be to others when certain information is released. And if we're talking about social care, there could be child protection issues, etc., that ready access to your record, as you're suggesting, would not protect these other individuals, the third parties. We have to bring people along in the process, and that's the social workers, the data controllers have to be transparent with the service users, and there has to be an understanding by the service users that there are these other issues, the legalities of access, etc. Our Information Commissioner, John Edwards, he came into post just in January, and he's taking a look at the way that we're dealing with certain sectors and putting a lot of emphasis on enhancing those, raising the awareness of those who've got unmet needs, raising awareness of their rights. And we're putting a lot of emphasis on that in our work now. And I can see a role in during this co-design process that we've spoken about previously and our consultations with the government as they bring the proposals forward. I can see a big role in us supporting the ways in which we can help the users see this. And I also would hope that, Paula, we have an engagement with you and colleagues in other organisations to help them there as well.
Thank you. Stephanie.
Thanks very much, Convener. I'm wondering as well, just staying with you there, Ken, just now, what about the role of the third sector and voluntary organisations as well, externally housing, homelessness, etc. as well there? So third sector, what role should they have in relation to the information sharing? And does the bill actually allow them to fulfil that role? Are there changes that might be needed around that? And then any comments that you have in the voluntary sector as well and other services that will be out with it, like housing and homelessness, etc. too. Thanks.
I think most of this will come through again in the detailed regulations that come through. But obviously the third sector has a major role to play in the delivery of social work and other care services. So they can't be ignored. I think it's for the partners in that work to ensure that the organisations themselves are properly trained and properly aware of their data protection responsibilities, that they have got good, strong data sharing agreements between them so that they know what they can share and when they can share it and who they can share it to. So it's again building in a strong framework, a strong infrastructure before the point of delivery, working with the partners, working with the patient and service users, advocacy groups, to make sure that we've got an effective system of data exchange.
Moving on from that, and in terms of implementation of, I suppose, bringing it back to, again, an interface, a single interface, which I'm guessing would be the goal that allows access to the systems and the information contained within those systems that people manage in someone's care, whether that being transitional from like a clinical setting to a care setting, being the goal. I guess I wanted to bring it from the perspective of those in the care sector right now, who told us yesterday when we were in Dumfries that at the moment they're having to put multiple entries into different systems of the same information, or they're having to access multiple systems at the moment, and this is actually taken away from the time that they actually spend with their clients. I wonder if anyone in the panel have any views on that as to how we can help the workforce with the goal of having a sort of single interface and how that could be manageable, because I think that's one of the reasons why this is coming up time and time again, is that the workforce are telling us that they are having, they either, like Sandesh is saying, from a health perspective, can't access certain systems where there's actual data and information that they require to access, but also in social care they're saying, well, you know, I'm spending so much of my time having to log into different systems in order to report on things or in order to to get information when it's taken away from the job that I'm supposed to be doing. Beth, I see you nodding. I know I'm rambling a little bit, but you get my point from the perspective of those on the ground. How do you see something being implemented to actually take down those the red tape around that?
Thank you, Convener. And yes, I was nodding along because my previous role was in mental health in Sussex. Setting up part of that was setting up the integrated service, care service there, and we had exactly the same problems you were talking about, where social work would have the system there, enter their data onto council systems, and mental health practitioners would enter onto NHS systems, and charities who were very active in the sector maybe had three standalone computers in a back office that didn't connect to anything at all. And so absolutely recognise what you're referring to there. And I think there is no easy answer. The ideal would be to have, first of all, common data standards, so people are collecting the same data, because what we find at the moment is each organisation will have its own set of data, they'll all be slightly different, and then to aggregate them becomes more difficult. So if we could agree data standards and that culture of sharing, because again, typically in Sussex we found that one organisation would say, oh no, we can't share that information with you because of GDPR. So our staff were having to enter data onto two separate systems controlled by two entities. So we have to build that culture of data sharing and the understanding of it. We have to build the common data definitions, and then we can look at aggregating the data as part of the wider system that we were talking about. But there is no quick fix, I don't think, based on 3 years' experience down south.
I wonder if anyone else wants to come in on that. I think Dr. Mee, and you have put in the chat box you want to come in, but I don't know if it's in relation to my question. I'll just go to you just to check.
Was in relation to this and to the previous point in relation to the third sector engagement.
Carry on.
In terms of third sector engagement, again, it was during the pandemic, I think the role of a lot of smaller third sector agencies in providing vital support came to the fore in a way that hadn't previously, but it also highlighted the fact that there was some weaknesses in terms of information governance in that space. And so we have been working and developing that since then in terms of, how can I put this, the bureaucratic parts of data protection. We've now agreed in Glasgow, there's a model that we're happy to share elsewhere as well. We've agreed that kind of bureaucratic part of data protection up front with the umbrella organisation, say Glasgow Council for Voluntary Services. So they have gone off and got lawyered up, use that term, and agreed a framework with the Council under which all of their members can quite happily enter into specific data sharing agreements in relation to the small work that they're doing. And that we're happy that we've got the information governance addressed, and that helps facilitate the joint working in that area. In terms of the current point in relation to joint services, there is a recognition that health and social care have been moving more closely together. To the point that in some areas of practice, it's recognised that you can't do it in isolation. So if you're dealing with addictions work in particular, and some aspects of mental health work as well, it really requires you both having clinical and social care interventions to make that done properly. And we recognise that by saying this is an area where we are jointly controlling that data. So it shouldn't matter whose computer it is you're entering the data in. If you're entering into that area representing an organisation, that organisation is controlling the data, you know, and you should recognise that in what you're saying to your staff, saying, oh, I'll only put this on that organisation's computer, even though I work for the council. You know, I, as a council employee, am doing things with that data, so you should recognise that the council has a role there. We've been trying to do that, and say it's increasingly becoming the norm in fields like addictions and mental health that more than one agency is controlling the data.
Thank you. I mean, Stephanie, you had questions on ownership of data. This is probably a good time to bring you in on your questions on that.
Yep, that's a really interesting one. I would like to hear a bit more about that, a bit more detail around that. But if my understanding is right, then there does seem to be consensus around individuals owning and controlling their data, and it's about consent, choice, setting limits, that has to be person-centred. And I'm wondering if you feel this should be stated actually on the face of the bill. If I could go to Paula first, thanks.
I think for our members, it should be something that is stated on the face of the bill. But obviously for a lot of them, they're seeing absolutely no mental health records being shared at all, whether or not there's the kind of option of being able to access it themselves and it being person-centred. So I just have to state that there is that kind of view as well from some of our members that they just don't want that to happen at all with mental health records. But yes, in general, from members wanting to have that put in there so that they know that it's absolutely guaranteed in a sense. Yeah.
Okay. I don't know if anybody else wants to come in that one. Okay.
Kim? Yeah, I absolutely understand what Paul is saying, but I have concern about the language that might be used, because person-centred may send the wrong signals. As Kenny mentioned before, there are times where we have to say, we can't ask for your consent on this. We've got a power imbalance. We're the local authority. You're needing our services, and you know there's an imbalance. So we have to be careful in that language. We also have to be careful, and dare I say it, when Beth said, well, we can't share because of GDPR. I know it wasn't you were quoting people, not yourself. There's normally a way through the data protection legislative framework to allow sharing. It's a matter of going and seeking the right advice, and that's part of our role, an educative one. And I'll also maybe just smile and take exception at Kenny's description of the bureaucracy of data protection. I'd call it good information governance, Kenny, and it's necessary, and it's key to the whole framework.
Thank you. Can I bring in Scott Held?
Just on that point, I think we do need to be really, really careful about, I guess, that balance between the opens and the health sphere first, the need for us to share data for things like service planning, understanding pathfinding, etc. So I think it does come back to the phrasing earlier about having a dialogue with individuals about kind of why it would be useful in these purposes. So I think that kind of carte blanche statement around people saying that they don't want their data to be shipped, I think is risky, because there are reasons why it's really, really important that we do share data and have that ability to understand kind of what's happening across populations.
Thank you. Stephanie, are there any more questions around this, or we'll move on?
Yep, just kind of touching back there as well on what Paula said originally. Now, I appreciate the fact that, you know, people are concerned, especially about mental health information being shared. However, that's also one of the key areas as well, where you're talking about people having trauma and having to repeat their story over and over again. So it's implicit, clearly, that they're able to share that information when that is something that's helpful to them. So I'm wondering about how we actually get that balance right, where human rights are respected too.
I don't know if I have an answer to that. But yes, definitely, members have talked about the re-traumatising effects of having to tell their story over and over again. But interestingly, a lot of the time, what they're mentioning there is within mental health services, where maybe the record hasn't been shared properly, or it hasn't been recorded properly, and that's where they're finding that they're actually having to retell the story rather than necessarily out with mental health services. But I do see what you're saying, but I'm afraid I don't have an answer.
I do really appreciate what you're saying there as well, because I know too that actually sharing details or too much information around traumatic experiences with someone that they're not happy about is also a traumatising experience too. And I don't know if any of the other panel members have got any comments on how we look at actually getting that balance right.
I'm just wondering if there's any way of flagging up certain parts of information on the record. And I don't know any of the scenarios well enough to give a proper example. But if we go back to the health scenario that we've referred to and is roughly parallel, and we often see cases where people are disputing what the doctor has on the record, and you'll be aware of this, but it's essential that the doctor's initial diagnoses are retained. They want us to say scrap it. We say no. Make a note that they dispute this, because ultimately in the history of the patient, it's essential to know what the initial diagnoses were and if they were correct and if they were wrong. Now, it's not a direct parallel, but I'm wondering if there is something in the mental health area where it's just the patient saying, I'm not happy. I understand you might have to keep it. I understand you might have to share it. But please note my concerns and flag it up that way.
Thanks very much.
Kenneth Meehan wanted to come in. I'll bring you in before it goes. A couple of members want to come in specifically.
Thanks, James. In relation to the point about control of the data, I think one of the important things, an area which can also cause trauma, is you need to know whose job it's going to be to fix it when you get it wrong. We shouldn't be naive enough to think that however securely we build a system, there won't be mistakes at some point and things will unfortunately go wrong. That's when, unfortunately, we have to be in touch with Ken's colleagues down in Wilmslow to notify them of data breaches. But I think that's something else that we need to bear in mind when we're designing this as well. And give a couple of examples I'm aware of where a local authority managed to lose a lot of data in relation to the housing of sex offenders in the community. The data found its way into the hands of the Sun newspaper when it was at the height of its hang a paedophile from the nearest lamppost campaign. The data breach in that case involved the emergency rehousing of a lot of those offenders. And that was a massive multi-agency task force had to be mobilised to deal with that as an issue. On a smaller scale, you have home carers who are going out to people's houses and have a piece of paper that's got the combination for the key safe on it. That piece of paper blew out the window of a van, and the data breach response there was we had to send tradesmen out to about 20 people's houses to change the combination of the key safe. That's the sort of thing where, again, it's really, really important for us to know who's going to be the controller of this data, because one of the important things the controller has to do is make things right when it goes wrong.
Thank you. A couple of members want to come in on this in particular. Emma?
It's just a quick thought about, yesterday in Dumfries, one of our one of the people around the table said that we should move away from talking about person-centred care and talk about relationship-centred care, which is based on trust between your carer at home, your carer who you live in a care home, or whatever. So I'm just wondering about your thoughts on the language that we use. Of course, we want person-centred approach because it is very dependent on what data is shared and who is allowed access to your data, like the key safe in your house that Ken is talking about. So I'm interested in just a brief thoughts about person-centred versus relationship-centred care.
I guess that Paul is a good person to go to.
I'm not sure if I've got an answer to that. Our members do talk a lot about person-centred care, but they also mention that often it's banded about, like you're saying, and it might not necessarily be doing what it's supposed to be doing. Relationship-centred care might be a good description if you're talking about between the clinician and the patient, but as long as it's not taking away any of the rights of the patient. But language is an important thing, but also quite a difficult thing to decide upon. I'm not sure if I've got a good answer for that.
Okay. Can I come to Evelyn? You have a question on this?
We know people want a shared record in whatever form that takes. The Scottish Government consultation showed 86% of people wanted it and they wanted it to be shared across platforms. But in relation to co-design, you said that people were anxious about what that looked like, what that meant, would they have enough time? Would it be helpful for further guidance or from the government about what that would look like to offer reassurance that there will be time to have these important conversations, you know, about control of data, mental health issues, whether and what might be shared and in what circumstances?
Useful and to know that there was actually going to be enough time to carry that out properly and have everybody consulted that should be consulted properly.
Emma, we have a sort of around monitoring and evaluation. You have some questions, and I'm just checking with members. We've got Evelyn wants to come in on this as well. If there's anyone that wants to pick up on any of the aspects that we've mentioned before we round off this panel session, can you please let me know? Emma.
Thanks, Convener. I will be really quick. So we've talked a lot about data and personal data this morning, but there's part of now a couple of questions around the monitoring and evaluation of a National Care Service as it's taken forward. And I'm interested to know if you think that the bill does have suitable information as introduced about the monitoring and evaluation of care as it's delivered, and is there anything that actually should be added in, or will this work on the face of the framework legislation in order to introduce what we mean when we want the service monitored and evaluated? Not sure who wants to go first. Darren, yes.
Yes, I think going back to my earlier point in relation to freedom of information, that the openness and the transparency that can provide to the systems lets there be increased accountability, allows for the monitoring. I think particularly if it's tied in with information standards, so that you've got what was mentioned earlier on about that consistent approach between bodies, so that you can compare like with like between the different care boards, for example. And while the care board level would be captured under freedom of information to enable that sort of analysis, what's not currently captured in the bill is the tier below. So, for example, you could get a person A whose care is being provided still by a local authority or by some other public body or the care board, and they get access to specific information. Person B is in a care services provided by a contracted out services, and they wouldn't have the same rights to information. So if we're looking at that consistency that's promised by the system, there's a risk that the actual architecture in relation to freedom of information rights will create inconsistencies. And I'm concerned that having a Section 5 order to remedy that later on is asking for a period of time when the inequalities will be there.
So it is interesting actually to talk about the whole like release of information, the sharing of information, the whole minutiae of the regulations that allow freedom of information requests, and then other I suppose the monitoring and evaluation to then be out there and be shared so that we can compare on how a board is doing versus another one. So that I find it really interesting, and we talk a lot about self-directed support, and that works really well in some places and doesn't in others. So we need to be able to monitor that. So do you think there should be something more detailed about data monitoring or monitoring and evaluation of the system? Like unmet need, for instance, is something that does that need to be in the face of the bill?
I think in terms of monitoring and evaluation, the piece I'm particularly interested in is the ability for the public to have that information so that they themselves are able to raise questions, concerns, have information, make informed decisions. And that's where the freedom of information piece comes in. And I'm concerned that the bill is an opportunity to consider it as part of the process, to build it in from the get-go, rather than to, you know, while it's dealing with all these other data considerations, it's an opportunity to build it in, consider it in the system as a whole, rather than viewing it as an add-on. And my concern is that for the system to work properly, it's helpful for Parliament, the committee, to have consideration of all of those issues at the same time and build it in, rather than, as I say, just dealing with it later on. And certainly, I think it's interesting how that would work with information standards and whether that in itself will help create consistency across the various service providers.
Okay. Emma's helpfully covered my question.
Okay, thank you. Gillian, final question to you then.
Oh, thank you. Just as a sort of overall question, the governance structures, the way information is stored, what's stored where and by who probably isn't particularly clear for many people. Does the panel think that this is the case, and what work would they like to see undertaken as part of the construction of the NCS to ensure everyone knows their rights and responsibilities going forward?
I've referred to the legal responsibilities that the organisations have, the government has, and the partners will have. It's essential that they consult with us. It's obligatory that they consult with us. And I would hope that we'd be able to assist them in the pathway to getting it right.
Thank you. Does anyone else want to come in on that? Just let me know. I've got Scott online has asked to come in. It might not be on Gillian's question. It might actually be on the last step. I'll bring in Scott anyway.
Yeah, thanks. Just a point about what Gillian was saying about monitoring evaluation. I think one of the real important things about any development of a national care record is thinking through the uses of the data once it's established. So I think all the stuff that Gillian was talking about unmet need, looking at health inequalities, and building it at the start, kind of how you're going to use the data once it's there, is going to be really, really important. So I think the fundamental part at the start that you talk through around how the data is going to be used. And in terms of that final question there about multi-agency, I think the answer is yes, it has to be multi-agency. There are lots of players in this space. In terms of the specific question about is it clear at the moment, I think it's safe to say, certainly from my perspective, it's not clear. But I think that's some of the important work that would have to happen at the start before it kicks off about exactly who's involved and what roles will be within that. Thank you.
Thank you. We've reached the end of our time with our first panel. I want to thank you all for your time this morning. We're going to suspend for 10 minutes for a break and allow our panels to change over. Thank you. Okay. Welcome back. We now move to our second evidence session, which is focusing on the bill in relation to regulation and quality improvement. And I welcome to the committee Rosemary Agnew, the Ombudsman of Scottish Public Services Ombudsman, or SPSO, Lindsay Cleland, the Director of Quality Assurance for Health Improvement Scotland, Suzanne McGuinness, the Executive Director of Social Work for the Mental Welfare Commission for Scotland, and Kevin Mitchell, Executive Director for Scrutiny and Assurance of the Care Inspectorate. And I think I'll actually come to Kevin first of all. The bill as it's drafted, what extent do you think the bill could improve the regulation of care and support services?
Thank you, Convener, and thanks for the opportunity to give evidence today. The Care Inspectorate, we welcome the bill, and particularly the aspiration to improve the quality and consistency of social work and social care services, and thereby the outcomes and experiences of people, which is what it should all be about. And we also welcome the underpinning principles of the National Care Service that are included in the bill. We recognise that it's a framework bill and as such doesn't have the detail that some perhaps are looking for, but we also understand that further detail will be forthcoming in due course, not least through draft regulations, consultation, co-design and co-production. However, you know, in our experience, whilst we recognise the potential of the bill and the aspirations which are very laudable, in our experience, structures or changes to structures won't on their own deliver change or high quality seamless services for people, particularly those who need those services the most. So crucially important in our view will be how that legislation is interpreted, how it's implemented and implemented consistently, and what will also be equally crucially important is how the National Care Service is led, managed and resourced. We know from our scrutiny evidence that what it will need above all else is a strong shared vision, strong collaborative leadership, strong and effective partnership working, good multidisciplinary working where relationships are key and have the potential to break down any artificial barriers that might exist, robust quality assurance and adequate resourcing. So again, just going back to the original question, there is, and we see the potential, particularly for the most vulnerable, and we welcome recognition of the importance in the bill to the independent scrutiny and assurance aligned to a quality improvement approach. And in that respect, we think the Care Inspectorate is well placed to carry that out. We already do that across a wide range of social work and social care services for babies, children, young people, adults and older people, and a strong record of working across complex structures. We're confident that we can continue to do that and deliver independent scrutiny assurance and support improvement effectively, whatever the structures are in place. And we certainly look forward to further discussions about how the detail of the bill and what its enabling powers are to be able to achieve all of that.
I mean, social care is already a very highly regulated sector. You may be aware that we've been doing some local outreach work in around in Fife yesterday, and it was put to me by somebody who was managing an independent care home, and about the burden of inspections. And multiple inspections in terms of staff capacity, and you know she put it to me that what they didn't want is another layer of inspections on top of it. Are you involved in the review at the moment on the inspections? I mean, what would be your response to that?
Yes, Convener, we are. I assume that you're referring to the independent review of inspections scrutiny regulation led by Dame Sue Bruce, and yes, we very much welcome that, and we look forward to engaging. We've already had a meeting with Dame Sue Bruce and Stuart Curry. We're very conscious of inspection, you know, when we go into any service, clearly it will be a distraction. But we take very seriously our responsibility to provide that independent assurance. But we always also take very seriously our duty to further improvement, and it's a statutory duty to further improvement in social work and social care. So when we go in to do inspection, we also are very clear that we will support improvement. We regard every single visit, every contact, every inspection as an opportunity to support improvement in the service. Yes, our statutory responsibility is to provide that independent assurance about the quality of care, the safety, protection and well-being of people, sometimes the most vulnerable people, be they children, adults or older people. So again, when we go into the service, we will seek to deliver all of that, and we always regard our inspections as doing it with people rather than to people. So we will engage in professional dialogue, we will signpost, we will try to identify good practice. But no matter how you package that, there are those that will sometimes feel it's a burden. I think sometimes the views of inspection might correlate to the outcome of the inspection, because overwhelmingly services are good and very good, and we don't often get complaints when we report the outcomes of those inspections as being very good or...
They were talking about the amount of inspections rather than the, any kind of outcomes. They were just sort of saying, you know, they were hoping that the National Care Service wouldn't be adding another layer on top of what they've already got to do in that regard.
Yeah. I suspect, Convener, what they might be alluding to, and I'm only guessing here, is that we would only seek to carry out inspections relative to an assessment of risk. We take an intelligence-led, risk-based approach to inspections. We clearly want to also look at services to identify good practice, so we've got to strike a balance there. But during the pandemic, what developed was an enhanced role for oversight groups in health and social care partnerships. Now, those have been very helpful in many respects, and we liaise very closely to the health and social care partnership oversight groups. But we've also aware that we've been told on many occasions about potential overlaps and some inconsistencies in how they approach that role in different areas. And some services perceive the role of the oversight groups to be a secondary form of inspection rather than support improvement. So I don't know if that is maybe what your people are mentioning. Yeah. And I don't want to speak in any way negatively about those oversight groups, because they have done some really good work and we've worked very closely with them. But I know that some feel that rather than offering support and guidance, they come in and more or less repeat what we have done. And I think that might be the source of some tensions that certainly have been made known to us. I wouldn't like to say how widely that's a view that's held, but that view that you've put forward, that sounds similar to what others have put forward to us as well.
Thank you. I want to bring it back to the and ask the views on the ministerial oversight aspect of the bill and how that might relate to the regulation of care in mental health services, and any thoughts. I think, Suzanne, if I can come to you first on that.
Yeah, in terms of the bill itself, obviously the Commission welcomes any and all measures to improve the quality and consistency of across social work and social care. And in terms of ministerial oversight of mental health services, we had submitted previously our views around the bill, and it seems to be it's set out quite broadly, and we would expect greater emphasis or made more explicit within the bill around parliamentary scrutiny of ministerial powers. And in terms of mental health services, this is a really complex landscape, as you can as you'll be more than aware. And we are currently working our way through the Scottish Mental Health Law Review. There's a lot in there that there's a clear crossover between what the NCS hopes to achieve and what the Scottish Mental Health Law Review hopes to achieve. And we would ask that these two combine whilst we kind of progress with National Care Service.
Lindsay, did you want to come in? I could see you nodding, but I'll you know. Another very specific issue which relates to our last panel, Rosemary Agnew, the evidence that was given by the Scottish Information Commissioner, SPSO was mentioned in the oral evidence for sure, and I just want to know your feedback on that aspect of their submission with regards to the SPCB or the Scottish Parliament corporate body and the officers there.
Thank you for the opportunity. I'm going to start with an apology that if I confuse you, it's because a lot of the information in the bill and the provision as drafted is quite conflicting in places, and we've tried very hard to unpick it in specific ways. And there are actually three issues relating to that ministerial powers. It's section 15 of the bill. The first one relates to being a parliamentary office holder. So we have concerns about the impact of the bill on office holders, and I know the SPCB has also written with their concerns. And it's worth taking us back to the Public Service Reform Bill. And when it was last proposed that the government were able to make changes to parliamentary supported bodies by secondary legislation, which is what this is doing, it was accepted that it was not appropriate to simply use an affirmative procedure to do that. Instead, protections were added to the bill, and then the Public Service Reform Act, as it became, to make it clear that secondary legislation would be for limited purposes only. And this super-affirmative procedure, specifically designed for this, was introduced because that reflected the importance of the independence of the status of office holders, not just myself, but the other parliamentary bodies. Now, this has an added dimension for the SPSO because since that time, the UN has endorsed something called the Venice Principles. It's a bit like the Paris Principles, but it relates to ombudsmen. And these principles ask states to ensure the independence of ombudsman schemes. Now, whilst we fully support the purposes and the intention of the bill, as Kevin set out, we do have a concern that the ability to change our powers in this way would actually undermine our independence, because it would be, admittedly, it would have to go through some sort of procedure, but it would make it secondary legislation to try and alter what is already complex legislation, and we're not sure that that would be appropriate. Now, there are also some very specific impacts of Section 15 in relation to complaints and ministerial powers, which I'm happy to cover here unless they're related to questions later.
Yeah, just please continue.
Yeah. Now the second area where Section 15 comes into play is in relation to our powers as a complaint standard authority. What I've tried to do is set out what the current situation is and what the bill might change. Now, we were given complaint standard authority powers through an appropriate parliamentary process in 2010. So what this means is the SPSO sets complaints handling standards for bodies under our jurisdiction. We monitor complaints handling performance. We support and drive learning and improvement, both in complaint handling and to get public bodies to use complaints to learn for themselves, good and poor practice. Now, we accept it's not ideal, but we've seen significant improvements because of model complaints handling approaches. Now, under our powers, we expect a complaint process to meet model complaints requirements and the principles that have been laid by and approved by laid before and approved by Parliament. Now, currently, all local authorities, health and social care partnerships, IJBs, health boards broadly apply that system. There are a few local differences, but effectively the process is the same. Now, the National Care Service will be established in the legislation as a function of Scottish ministers, which means it's under the SPSO's jurisdiction. So in theory, it's also under our jurisdiction for model complaints handling. Now, Section 15, this is where we come on to the what might transpire, of the draft bill, is making ministers a model complaints standards authority, so a complaint standards authority for the National Care Services and potentially social services, because it gives them the equivalent power to issue complaints procedures for those areas. Now, my view is this is incongruent with the powers that Parliament has already given the SPSO, and I think it runs the risk of creating different systems for different parts of public services. Now, it's difficult to say in detail what the impact would be, but if we come right back to one of the fundamental aims, which is to make this easier and simpler and a better service for complainers and for service users, ideally we want a service that doesn't result in complaints, but I don't think it would be helpful to further complicate an already complex landscape. And then the final area where Section 15 may come in, it's in my primary powers, they are linked to the body that is delivering the function. So my powers apply because the body is delivering a function and it's in my jurisdiction. Now, we think there could be an unintentional consequence here to reduce the accountability of some of my primary functions. So this relates specifically to our ability to consider the merits of some decisions. So under social work powers that we were given in 2017, and this was after significant consultation and through the super-affirmative procedure, we are able to look at the merits of professional decisions made by social workers and social services. So, but these powers are linked to the accountable body, so the local authority. We have the same for health, so that's linked to the health board. But if these functions were moved to the National Care Service without any saving provisions in the bill, we think that it will end our powers in relation to the merits of decisions. Put simply, we don't think we'd be able to challenge professional social work decisions and complaints because of the way the bits of the legislation interact together. And I think this would just, again, be a very retrograde step in terms of the creation of an ombudsman that effectively is a one-stop shop. And also, again, I think there is likely to be unintentional consequences of complexity for how and where complaints go. Now, the Scottish Government's confirmed that our understanding is correct, but we also have a concern that it might impact in a similar way for some health-related complaints, if any health functions are transferred, and for whistleblowing complaints, because since April 2021, I'm also the independent national whistleblowing officer. Now, we've not been able to assess exactly what the impact would be because we don't have as much of the detail. Now, the Scottish Government have said, because you know we've been able to work positively with them, that they would use their Section 15 powers to reinstate the social work related powers, but that seems a bit the wrong order in my view. The co-design that's going on at the moment, it's a great way of involving lived experience for designing the service, and presumably some of that will relate to complaints. But we think, given our powers were confirmed through either primary legislation or the super-affirmative process, we are still concerned about the appropriateness of Scottish Government being able to change primary legislation to suit what they want to see coming out of complaints. What we would much rather do is be part of the co-design to see if we can't put the complaint systems we have, you know, make them better rather than introduce something completely new.
What you've said will inform our questioning of the Minister on this specific issue, so thank you very much. Can I move on to questions from Emma Harper on the National Social Work Agency?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everybody. There's a couple of bits of information in our papers about the establishment of a new National Social Work Agency. So I'm interested in what the panel's thoughts are on the creation of a centralised quality improvement body for, like in the form of a National Social Work Agency. And is that something that you welcome, or would you prefer to see some alternative approach? And if so, what would that be? I suppose, can we go to Suzanne first?
First of all, I would say that the Special Social Work, and I understand from my colleagues across the board, are fully supportive of our National Social Work Agency. And it's really important for the social work profession to gain parity of professional recognition with integration partners across the board. What that looks like, whether that's an integrated National Social Work Agency or a standalone, as long as it's there and we gain parity. The Commission itself is fully supportive of the National Social Work Agency, and I think we think that it offers an opportunity for social workers to operate in the way that we're trained and intended within communities, relationship-based practice, and using our professional social work knowledge, skills and values to best effect. And that's a shift away from the current evolution towards gatekeepers in effect. And I would add on to that as well, in terms of the Chief Social Work Officer, it would be helpful, I think, to see the role of the Chief Social Work Officer aligned with the National Social Work Agency and actually on the face of the bill.
I'm not sure if anybody else wants to comment. I see Kevin Mitchell.
Thank you. I'm not a social worker, but I've worked very closely with social workers at both a strategic and operational level for almost all of my 45 years of public service. Whilst the detail is unclear, the Care Inspectorate recognises the potential benefits in what's proposed through creating a National Social Work Agency, particularly in terms of promoting the value of social work and supporting improvements in learning and development opportunities for social workers and indeed social work managers. That in itself, we feel, could help attract more entrants to the profession and improve retention as well. I think care, although would have to be taken to ensure that there's no duplication of functions already undertaken by other bodies, for example, the Scottish Social Services Council in terms of standards of education and training. The Care Inspectorate also welcomes the tone on the bill about recognition of the unique task of social work, which is very closely aligned to, but not necessarily synonymous with, social care. Social work and social workers make a unique contribution to any multidisciplinary approach to delivering health and social care services. They have particular skills, knowledge and experience, and a strong values based of social justice, which I don't think, in my experience, are always well understood. They're often working with the most difficult and complex of cases, balancing conflicting needs and views and making professional judgments in the most difficult of circumstances around child and adult protection, for example, or managing high-risk offenders. So I suppose, in totality, Children and adults don't live in isolation from each other. They live in families and they live in communities. And whilst there's arguments for and against the inclusion of social work services, children's injustice in a national care service, I think what's critically important is that those services are not disaggregated, because we know from our scrutiny evidence that services delivered by adult social work services, both in terms of drug and alcohol treatment or in terms of justice, those services or not can impact on children and vice versa. So whatever the decisions are made, it would be important, I think, to look very carefully before those are disaggregated. And in terms of the national service, I think, again, whatever the structure that's put in place, we would hope that social work and social care and the staff therein are valued, and that social work particularly are valued and represented at all levels of the National Care Service, with the National Social Work Agency being in addition to and not instead of this representation, and able to consolidate progress and a number of agencies that work together with social work.
Okay. You talked about quality and education, and that's something that has come up in previous evidence session. This might be a question for Lindsay as well, but we heard yesterday in Dumfries that some of our carers they're doing PEG tube feedings, and they're actually really complex skills and skills that do need to be valued. And as a former nurse educator, I think it's really important that we measure and monitor and make sure that people are delivering this complex care that they're doing. So what we heard yesterday was that older, skilled, experienced care workers might retire early rather than undertake mandatory training. Is that something that you've heard about already, or have you got experience about that? Because is there maybe a plan that older, experienced people that might not want to achieve the level that's been required, they'll be able to continue to work in their capacity as they demonstrate a lot of these skills already?
I suppose if it can potentially come in more broadly, I think that point about the kind of balance of skill mix within the professions and across health and care professions is really, really important. And the ongoing maintaining of skills, and again ensuring that those ongoing skills development and training is delivered in an achievable way and that is meeting the needs of service providers. So it's going to be a really important balance to be had in terms of moving forward, and I think that kind of wider considerations around workforce, the resources and the skills that are needed across the health and care spectrum. I suppose maybe kind of picking on some of the broader considerations around kind of quality improvement and some of, if you like, some of the key conditions for that. And I think the important interplay between the kind of the professionals providing care and the systems and the structures that they're working in. I think from our perspective, it's just really important that the kind of quality improvement framework is a kind of working to a consistent and connected framework across health and care, where we have that kind of consistency of language and methodology and approach, again, to help to ensure that it's that integrated experience for people who are using services, no matter what point of the care that they're on. And I think certainly from our experiences of the work that we've been doing in terms of improvement support across both health and care, it's just vitally important that we have individuals providing that improvement support who have kind of the skills and experience to do it, that it is being co-designed and that it's very much been tailored to the needs and the specific issues that are looking to be addressed.
Yeah, just going back, I think, to one of the points you made, we certainly recognise the staffing pressures across health and social work and social care at the moment, and there isn't a day goes by where we're not faced with that in our day-to-day work. I think it's also important to acknowledge that across, again, health and social care sectors, staff are huge levels of professionalism, commitment and dedication, and it is true public service. It's a vocation, and those staff need to be valued, they need to be recognised, they need to be have reward packages that recognise what they do. In terms of the staffing pressures that we're probably all aware of, we know that there's work ongoing to attract younger people into those professions, to new entrants into those professions. But to pick up a point that you made, which I think is a really important point, in both health and social care, and indeed in social work, you need to retain the high levels of experience of those individuals who have acquired that experience over sometimes a long number of years to train and mentor and support people coming into the profession. So it's hugely important. I couldn't speak to the demographics. You know, we could, if necessary, provide some information from a social work, social care perspective, perhaps, if that was of interest to the committee. But anecdotally, we do know that there are these challenges, and we do know and do hear of people leaving social work and social care perhaps earlier than might have been expected. But again, we could only guess. There could be a number of reasons for that. It may be related to what people have gone through in the pandemic. It may be related to a number of other things. But there is no doubt that there has to be a considerable effort to recruit and retain high quality staff, because those staff are ultimately crucial in delivering high quality health, social work and social care. So that, and without those staff, we wouldn't be able to deliver that care that everybody would hope to receive if ever we were unfortunate enough to need it ourselves.
Final question. Yep. So going back to the creation of a national social work agency, it's in the policy memorandum on page 3 that the creation of a national social work agency, that's part of the plan, but it's not in the bill. So does it need to be in the bill? It seems pretty significant to me that if we're going to create a national social work agency, if that's what is proposed, that should it be in the bill, on the face of the bill?
Yeah, I would absolutely agree that the National Social Work Agency should be on the face of the bill. As I say, along with the clear role of leadership and accountability that the Chief Social Work Officer in each partnership area brings, that leadership role cannot be undervalued or in any way. And there's also, from the Mental Welfare Commission's point of view, the Chief Social Work Officer, on the face of the bill, along with the National Social Work Agency, whatever that's going to look like. But from a mental health perspective, there's adults with incapacity, and the Chief Social Work Officer acts as the proxy decision maker for people that are sadly unable to make, or no longer able to make, some decisions for themselves. And I wouldn't want that to be lost, and that the sheer significance of the role that local authority guardianships can play in people's lives. And therefore, it's really, really important that the National Social Work Agency, along with that role, sits on the face of the bill to make it explicit.
Thank you.
Yes, you had a question in this area.
Yes, I did. And it was directly to Kevin, if I may. Can you explain the Care Inspectorate's opposition to the National Social Work Agency?
If I've understood you correctly, explain our opposition mm-hmm. to it. I don't think anything I said earlier, unless I've got it wrong, was in any way suggesting anything other than us seeing the potential benefits. In terms of...
I thought in the submission there was some opposition to it. Am I mistaken?
Certainly, the collective views of the Care Inspectorate would be that whilst we don't have the detail, and it's difficult to comment when you don't have the detail, we certainly recognise the potential benefits of promoting social work. And I think the only qualification we would say is that in the creation of that, if that were to pass, it would just be important to ensure that there was congruence and not duplication with the roles of other bodies such as the Scottish Social Services Council. I don't think, in highlighting that, I don't think that in itself is anything that would necessarily indicate a reason not to create a national social work. It's just making sure that the roles and responsibilities are aligned to the new structure and with existing structures, if those indeed remain, so that services that are working together are not at odds with each other in terms of their individual roles and remits. So again, very clear that, you know, we think there are potential benefits, and clearly as the consultation continues and there's co-design processes and further engagements with government officials, no doubt, as we've had already, then we will be able to comment more on the detail. But I certainly see that the opportunities that that might create for the reasons I gave earlier.
And now move on to talk about mental health support and protection. Questions led by Gillian Mackay. Gillian.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. What risks are attached to separating different social work functions, with some falling under the National Care Service and others remaining with local authorities? Could this create additional barriers and undermine the provision of a holistic, person-centred social work service? And I don't know who wants to go first.
Susan, been here. Yeah, in terms of risks of different social work functions sitting in various different structures, I would say that the Commission would strongly support a congruent and coherent structure. The move together. We cannot break things up. If we break things up, then we end up with more of the same. And we're looking, seeking to improve barriers in terms of social work functions. If we have social workers, for example, being commissioned from local authority into a National Care Service, into a local care board, that leaves the profession of social work in an exceptionally challenging position. It would undermine and dilute the profession. So therefore, that's a key barrier. If we're talking purely around the risks of the different social work functions, there's obviously within that the social workers who are trained as mental health officers, and ensuring that the mental health officer role sits alongside social work colleagues as well. So it moves together under NCS.
So just to add to that, probably coming back to yourself again, Suzanne, what opportunities do you think there are for the National Care Service to improve mental health support and protection?
There are opportunities with the National Care Service, but as colleagues both here and in previous sessions have probably highlighted, there's still a lack of detail. We are currently working through, as I said before, the Scottish Mental Health Law Review that was published, and we're in the process of considering that. And equally awaiting the Scottish Government views around the recommendations. In terms of opportunities, we would suggest that the National Care Service, as we can move forward, looks at the human rights enabling approach within the Scottish, which is outlined within the Scottish Mental Health Law Review. In addition, we would request cognizance of UNCRPD and International Covenant of Economic, Social and Cultural Rights for individuals across Scotland. There's a clear crossover here between what is hoped to be achieved through the National Care Service and Sections 25 to 27 of the current Mental Health Act in Scotland around economic, social and cultural rights. Right now, Sections 25 to 27 are certainly, it would be, you know, polite of me to say that they're certainly not fully realised at this time in terms of individual rights who come under the Mental Health Act. The Commission fully supports the early intervention and prevention, which the NCS, again, talking about opportunities, could realise. And in coming here today, the Royal College of Psychiatry actually approached me. And we're in agreement, as with them and with the Scottish Mental Health Law Review, in doing so, and thinking about early intervention and prevention, which is at the heart of social work, but equally, we would call for the focus not to be lost for those individuals affected by severe and enduring mental health and who are at greatest risk. There's a real balancing act here. The NCS alignment, as we progress forward, aligning with the Scottish Mental Health Law Review and its recommendations, could ensure and feel really, everybody, I think, in terms of mental health world, feels really strongly in ensuring mental health gains parity with physical health. So in answer to your question, quite simply, yes, there are opportunities here for the NCS and mental health. Thanks,
Carol, you had some questions on this.
It was really just to clarify, you know, were there hurdles that you felt could be overcome to, you know, to get mental health within the bill, or did you feel that we wouldn't be able to do that?
In terms of having mental health on the face of the bill?
On the face of the bill, yeah.
I think there's certainly, and I think my colleagues would certainly agree, in terms of subsections 27 and 28 within the bill, it talks about transfer of services, and again looking at Mental Health Law Review and colleagues in Royal College and the Commission, we can agree that there's wide-ranging powers there, and there's concern over that in terms of what does that actually mean. So we know that under Schedule 3 that the Mental Health Act, for example, and local authority duties are within the bill, but it's really difficult to see what that means. Some of the concerns around, it's a really complex landscape. And I know that, for example, the Royal College of Psychiatry are concerned about the transfer of, lifting mental health services from NHS into local care boards or specialist care boards, and what that looks like. And would call for a co-design of all stakeholders in order to ensure that mental health services sit in the right place. There is no argument around having clear pathways for individuals around mental health and improving current pathways. There's a raft of work going on, as you'll be aware. So I don't know if that answers your question to some extent.
Yeah, it does, but clearly some of the legislative stuff really needs to be worked through before we could, you know, be comfortable that people would be protected and things would be happening as they should be.
I would absolutely agree with that, being really, really clear. And again, I draw your attention to the Scottish Mental Health Law Review. There's a raft of background information there in terms of really honing down what is required. And yeah, I would absolutely call for clarity and detail on the face of the bill around what is meant by the transfer of mental health services, and indeed the transfer of local authority duties under mental health legislation and capacity legislation and adult protection and so on.
Thank you.
I'm going to stick with you because I think you had a question or two on joint inspections.
Yeah, we actually took some evidence from people working in the field yesterday, and they were talking about inspections. And obviously we know it's such an important part that we do have that ability to go in and see how services are performing. And there was some talk about during the pandemic there were joint inspections. I just would like a little bit more information about, you know, what were the benefits of that? And in terms of this bill, would it be beneficial to really look at who and how and why we're inspecting, services? I don't know who. Kevin, yeah.
I'm happy to take that one. Just by way of context, just to indicate to you, if you're not already aware, the Care Inspectorate has a long and strong track record of joint inspections, working with Healthcare Improvement Scotland, Education Scotland, His Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary in Scotland, His Majesty's Inspectorate of Prisons, His Majesty's Inspectorate of Prosecutions, and indeed Mental Welfare Commission. We've worked successfully with two of those bodies, three of them, His Healthcare Improvement Scotland, HMICS, the Police Inspectorate, and Education Scotland for over 10 years. We've also, again, a strong track record that I've alluded to of working across complex structures. So, again, from a Care Inspectorate perspective, we're confident that we can continue to deliver independent scrutiny and assurance that supports improvement effectively whatever structure is in place and whatever services are within or out with the scope of a national care service. In terms of, I think, what you're asking specifically, perhaps was what you're alluding to was during the pandemic, we welcome in this bill the proposal that Healthcare Improvement Scotland may assist the Care Inspectorate in carrying out an inspection of a care service, and I think that's under Section 43, for a fee. And we note from the financial memorandum that it's proposed to be a measure used in extremis, used in exceptional circumstances only. And I suppose that was arising from the pandemic when, during the main period, I think it was around April 2020, His Healthcare Improvement Scotland agreed to request for the Care Inspectorate for mutual aid and support, which initially focused on case holding, but they began to join us with an inspection, and up until April 21, I think they joined us on about a third of all the inspections of care homes for adults that we undertook. So just to reinforce, whether it's in the context of the specific proposal of the bill in terms of Section 43 and the exceptional circumstances, or whether it's in general terms, we certainly have a long history of joint inspections with a significant number of partner scrutiny bodies, and we think that would be something that we would envisage potentially requiring to be done more. But that, again, much depends on what services are within or out with. And I suppose it relates to the earlier conversation as well in terms of mental health services and community health services, because, for example, adults in a care home still rely very heavily on community services, community health services, services delivered by a GP. So there may well be discussions to be had about how those collective approaches might work in a new model of inspection. And I suppose that's why we welcome the independent review of inspection, scrutiny and regulation by Dame Sue Bruce, which is looking, I suspect, specifically at that, not necessarily at us or Healthcare Improvement Scotland or the Scottish Social Services Council, but actually to look at the existing scrutiny approaches to see how those may need to be developed in the context of a national care service going forward. So again, we're very much up for those discussions, and if we can help government officials or indeed this committee in any way, we're happy to do so.
Lindsay?
Thank you. So I think just to very much echo the comments that Kevin made in terms of the very strong working relationship that Healthcare Improvement Scotland and the Care Inspectorate have, and indeed that we have with a range of other partner agencies. So at Healthcare Improvement Scotland, we undertake a range of assurance activities across both NHS and independent healthcare services, and work in partnership with the essentially the same organisations that Kevin has already listed there. And I think we're, again, really keen to build on that collaboration so that we continue to ensure a consistent and connected external and internal assurance approach to very much support ongoing improvements in care. I think it's really incumbent on all of the scrutiny and assurance bodies to continue to draw on the intelligence that's available to us in terms of where we're targeting our assurance activities, and also making sure that that's done in a coordinated way, whether it's through joint activity or, again, being aware of where other organisations may be having a footprint, so that we don't have services kind of feeling like there's different organisations turning up on their doorstep within quick succession. So that's something we're currently working very closely on and would continue to do. And again, I think we welcome the clarity that the bill's bringing about other areas in which we can continue to build on the collaborative work that we already have in place. And I think really just the kind of final point is that really kind of the importance of ensuring that the scrutiny assurance and indeed improvement support for both health and social care services is very much joined up to reflect the complex pathways of care that people experience.
Sorry, yeah, go.
although the Mental Welfare Commission, it's neither an inspector nor a regulating body. We work with individuals to safeguard and promote a person's human rights in the mental health and capacity context. And I would, on this particular point, I'd ask you to kind of look at the Scottish Mental Health Law Review, which discusses inspection scrutiny in the context of, obviously, mental health. And it makes recommendations for the Commission, particularly. There's an expansion of role there. We're still considering it as a Scottish Government, so we'll see what happens further on down the line. And with my colleagues there, I totally agree, the Commission would agree with working collaboratively, providing, from our point of view, providing expertise in the field of mental health, and as required. For example, at the moment, through David Strang's recommendation, we're currently chairing a recently developed group around mental health and learning disability, and key to that is the coordination and communication across regulation and inspection bodies with key partners sitting around the table, particularly in these fields. So I just wanted to highlight that point as well.
Just one small thing, just to get a bit of understanding, just because it was raised with us, in terms of sometimes has charge fees for their inspections and stuff. It's just to get a bit of an understanding of where that comes from and if that would continue in the National Care Service.
Just to clarify, we don't charge fees for our inspections. I think the point within the face of the bill was the ability, if we were asked to support the care inspectorate with inspection activity of care services, the provision that we would be able to charge the care inspectorate for the cost of doing that. If we take the example of when we provided support during the pandemic in relation to drawing on our expertise around infection prevention and control in care home inspections, we did that by redeploying existing inspection staff, drawing on their experience, knowledge and skills to support that piece of work. And we were able to do that at that point because some of our other inspection programmes had been paused. And again, it would very much depend on the nature of the ask. If it was a kind of short-term piece of support that was being requested, again, we would probably look to deploy staff and to pause or rephase existing work programmes. I think where any considerations around the potential in terms of resource costs would be a consideration would be if it was something that was a longer term piece of support that would then require us to think about how we deliver that support in conjunction with the range of other inspection and assurance functions that we currently carry out.
Oh, thank you. Thanks.
Thank you, Carol. Stephanie, you have questions on the role of the SPSO, obviously. We've dipped into that a little bit already with Rosemary in response to my questions around the Information Commissioner's evidence earlier on. But if you'd like to ask the questions that you have, that would be great.
So I think we've dipped into it a big bit. I think Rosemary went into detailed answers earlier on with my questions around complaints. So just a couple of smaller points. I'm not even sure if these are things that you'll really be able to answer straight off there. But firstly, Chapter 3 of the bill is about creating a charter, and I'm wondering if you would expect that to be limited to principles or to include rights and responsibilities, for example, waiting times and complaints, similar to what we've seen in the Patients' Rights Scotland Act. So how would you kind of see that working? And secondly, wondering if ministers should have a duty to ensure advocacy services are available for those with disabilities or other needs in a similar way to we had in the Social Security Bill. So if I direct that at Rosemary first and happy for others to come in. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you. I think with the Charter, I was involved when they developed the Charter for the Social Security Agency, and broadly I support the concept of charters because it's almost like an emotional or a social contract between a public body and a service user, and it works both ways. I think in practice what we see is in a complaints handling environment, we don't often have need to refer to the charters because the charters refer more to the overall principles of service. I would be mindful of including too much detail in terms of timescales or numbers, and I use as an example the waiting time guarantee that's in health regulation. that is almost like a hostage to fortune if you include too much detail and the landscape changes or other things structurally change. But I think in terms of principles, it's a very good approach. Now, in terms of advocacy, this is something that professionally I feel strongly about, but personally I also feel very strongly about. And in relation to advocacy, we tend to think about groups of people needing advocacy. And we use this general term advocacy for all sorts of things. But actually, it's about supporting people at a point of vulnerability. And you can be, it could be us, it could be me tomorrow, who something traumatic happens and I need support. And I think the issues that I see with advocacy relate to there is inconsistent access to advocates. It depends on where you live, on what the services you want an advocacy for. And advocates also can perform different functions. They can be there purely in a supportive role, or they can be there representing somebody. And I think what the principles that I would, if I dare say, advocate, that we think about, are about the access and easy access to advocacy at the point of need, whether it's to access complaints or whether it's simply to interact with the service. What type of advocacy would be appropriate? Who puts the person in touch with an advocate? Because if you are trying to deal with something really traumatic in life, the last thing you're going to be thinking about is, where do I go for an advocate? So I think there's responsibility on public bodies in this respect. But I think we also have to think about the support and training that advocates receive. Because in a more professional context, a well-trained advocate can make a huge difference for an individual. But very often the people who are advocating are relatives, friends, charities who may not have that same background. And I think some thought has to be given as to what we mean by advocacy and how we get people access to that advocacy in a consistent way.
Okay. Thank you.
Kevin wants to come in, Stephanie.
Thank you. If I could just answer that question in the context of complaints in relation to the Charter and advocacy, it was just, I suppose, to be mindful that the Care Inspectorate already has a unique statutory responsibility for complaints about regulated care services, distinct from social work or health, or those services delivered in an integrated landscape. And our view about the regulated care service complaints processes is, as it stands, is it's working well. We regard every complaint as an opportunity to improve, because that's what it's about. It's an opportunity to improve the care that people receive. And how complaints are dealt with by a provider can tell us a lot about that provider. Intelligence from complaints that we receive are critically important to our wider role of scrutiny and improvement support. And we cannot and would not want to stress enough of the importance that we attach to that, about retaining that link, being able to quickly and effectively gather intelligence through dealing quickly and effectively with the complaints. We deal, I'm not sure if you'd be aware of this, we deal with around 6,000 complaints a year. The number has risen steadily from 2011, from 2,800. And the general increase may indicate that there's a greater awareness of our complaints process for regulated care services and greater awareness amongst people about standards of care that they and others should expect to receive. But relating that specifically to your question about a charter, I'm old enough to remember the creation of the Children's Charter. And the Charter of Rights proposed in the bill, we think, could be helpful to people who use services, their families and carers, to help them understand their rights to receive care and support, to know their rights and what they should expect in terms of social work and social care, including how to make a complaint. So I think there's certainly mileage in that. We do acknowledge that it's likely to be more challenging for people who use services and their families or carers to make a complaint about integrated services that may involve a number of health and social work and social care services working together. And it may well be that that is what the bill is seeking to address. We're not entirely clear on that. But regardless, we think it's important that the route for making complaints, our own complaint procedure, is based on the complaint modelling model, complaint handling guidance from colleagues in the SPSO and its model complaint handling procedure. So there is relevance to what was said earlier as well. But in terms of the final point, I think, about advocacy, we note that there's provision in the bill for regulations to be made for advocacy, and we think it would be important to consider that specifically in relation to complaints, particularly for those with communication difficulties. So, again, I don't know if that's helpful.
Thank you, Convener. It's just to follow on from a point that Rosemary made, and that we welcome Section 13 of the bill in terms of advocacy. And we'd submitted in our previous submission that a clarifying definition, and I think this follows on from what Rosemary's saying in terms of we're talking there about an independent advocate. And the definition is set out by the Scottish Independent Advocacy Alliance about giving people a right to a voice, human rights respected, recognised and secured. And equally, NCS Bill could use this opportunity to fill gaps for specialist advocacy. Now, I know that we're nowhere near yet in terms of where children, young people, for example, are going to be sitting. But should it get to the point that we do have clarity around that, we know through our work, and I think next week we publish our Children and Young People's Monitoring Report, in which we highlight the dearth of specialist children and young people's advocacy services for children that are detained in non-specialist wards. So I would certainly have a call for using, if we can, use this bill to really make a difference in terms of the delivery of advocacy services. And I think one of the key points that Rosemary makes equally is around well-trained advocates that can be really there to support people and navigate them through a really complex landscape. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Stephanie. Rosemary, apologies. And you come.
I was trying to be discreet. I just wanted to pick up on a couple of the points. The first one was in relation to children and young people. We are all anticipating the UNCRC being incorporated into Scots law. And I think one of the things within that is this right to your opinions being heard, children's rights in that. I think advocates will be a crucial part of that. The other point, just picking up something that Kevin said about advocates in a complaints context, very often by the time something reaches a complaint, you have emotion and stress and worry, but there is always, I think, by the time particularly that it reaches the stage two or it reaches us, there's also a breakdown in relationships. And I think advocates can play a vital role in helping to rebuild some of those, because they can be both realistic with complainers, but also they can perhaps, as Kevin said, help articulate some of the issues in a much more constructive way. And I'm reflecting on, you know, some of the excellent work that we see Patient Advisory Service doing in the NHS. And very often when you're looking at a complaint that's been brought by a representative through Patient Advisory Services providing support, it's often easier for all parties to focus on the underlying real issues of it. I couldn't underestimate enough what my colleagues have said as well.
Thank you. We now want to talk about the transfer of services. Paul, you have questions on this, if you'd like to lead it.
Thank you very much, Convener. Yes, I wonder if I might explore the whole notion of social work being within scope of the NCS. Obviously, that wasn't included in FILE. So I suppose my first question would be, why do you believe, or what are your thoughts on why that wasn't in the FILE review? And secondly, what would the potential impact be of transferring those services into the National Care Service? And I'll maybe start with Suzanne, if that's possible.
You mean the context of transferring the entirety of social work?
Well, yes. I'm going to come on to talk, I suppose, about it, what a separation might look like. But yes, if we were to transfer, as envisaged, certainly criminal justice services, for example, what impact do you think that would have?
I think there needs to be a consultation across the board in terms of criminal justice services and children's services indeed. And it'd be remiss of me to make any kind of full comments on that in the absence of consultation through the Mental Welfare Commission. However, there are cons and there are pros. And I think it would be for the social work profession to be fragmented would be a risk if we don't kind of come together. But in the absence of detail in its entirety, it's difficult for me to have a full kind of informed view on that at this time.
Sure. Kevin, I appreciate the Care Inspectorate pointed to those services not being included in FILE, so I wonder if you might comment in that context as well.
Yeah, I mean, clearly FILE's focus was on adult services, but I think as it came to pass, there was consideration of what children's services, whether they should be part of a National Care Service or not. Clearly, consideration needs to be given to whether children's services and indeed justice services are the round. And I suppose all I would say is that we welcome the public consultation that's now taking place before any transfer of services. The bill as it stands, as we understand it, proposes to give ministers power to transfer quite a broad range of services, social care, social work, and community health functions. And I think all of that would seem to us to need careful consideration. In terms of children's and justice, we know there are arguments for and against, but as I said earlier, I think we would caution against disaggregation of those social work services. And I would just point to the example I gave earlier that children and adults don't live in isolation from each other, and services that are provided or not to children and young people, whether they be from justice services or indeed from mental health or indeed drug and alcohol treatment services, those have an impact on the children, and indeed services provided or not to children have an impact on adults that are caring for them. So there's a connectedness of social work across the lifespan and indeed to social care in the round. So I think it needs very careful consideration. And I suppose the only other thing I would point to in terms of requiring careful consideration in that context is the very particular arrangements around child protection and adult protection. We know that at a strategic level, the chief officers play a key role in the strategic overview of child and adult protection, and many of them have now transformed into public protection, where they cover collectively the chief executives of health, social work, and the local authority take the strategic lead in both child and adult protection and indeed the management of high-risk offenders in the community. So again, none of that precludes any consideration being given to the responsibilities transferring, but I just think all of that requires careful consideration, because whilst, for example, in public protection committees, in our inspection experience, the chair of those public protection groups at the most senior level is often done rotating between the chief executive of the local authority, the health board, and indeed the police commander. So again, none of that, as I say, necessarily precludes being inclusion in a National Care Service, but I think all of that requires careful consideration. And of course, alcohol and drug partnerships fall into that consideration as well. But I think above all else, we would say that we would advise against the disaggregation of social work, because I think that could have potentially detrimental effects, whatever the structures might be.
I think Rosemary? No.
Just picking up on some of Kevin's themes from a complaints perspective of what we see, where we see some of the issues are between transitions from adult to child to adult. We see the complexity comes where there are different agencies involved. And the argument for keeping services together and coherent, I think, which Kevin has made, is one that's difficult to argue against when you look at where the issues currently arise. But I was reflecting when preparing for this, I did prepare, we're in danger, I think, of focusing on service, and actually at the heart of this is people. And one of the dangers, I think, of focusing on which bit of the service do we put here, which bit do we put there, we perhaps are in danger of missing people's life journey. Their life journey and the number of times and ways that they will interact with a care service, with a mental health service. And perhaps if we look at it in terms of life journeys, it might make some of the congruence that Kevin is referring to a little more easy to comprehend. Because I must admit, trying to put it purely in terms of service, you end up in your heads going round and round, I think.
Ms. Mary, we're all listening to you, and what you've said chimes in with what we heard particularly in our Aberdeen visit with Camp Hill, when they were talking about residents and their care reaching the point where they might have to, reaching 60, 65, and have to transfer into services that they couldn't offer because of their age. So thanks for bringing that up. Lindsay, I think you wanted to come in on that.
I think it was just to kind of very much echo those points around the really importance of thinking about the journey of care and absolutely that connected approach, whether it's between acute services, community services, social care, so that we have that continuum. And I think, again, wherever we do draw the structural lines, there's going to be interface issues that will need to be managed. So I think, again, the focus needs to be on ensuring the leadership and the governance arrangements in place to work across any structural or organisational boundaries, essentially to the benefit of those who are accessing services.
And I guess that's actually probably one of the reasons that this service, National Care Service, has been put forward. As an idea, is to address some of the issues around services not being joined up and gaps appearing. So it's good to bring it back to that. Paul, do you have any more questions?
Yeah, I wonder if I can just return to the point about the sort of fragmentation of the social work profession, because I think what we here have heard and what I hear from social workers is that real concern that if you take social workers out of the local authority context, you run the risk of, particularly in children and families services, there being a real disconnect between, for example, education, who have a role within child protection as well, and teams around the child and all those sorts of issues, and that you lose that link. So, I mean, would people recognise that that is a significant risk? Suzanne?
There is risk there. But there's equally the risk of a fragmentation of social work as a profession and what that means. And I think Rosemary outlined it beautifully there in terms of people's lives as a journey. And social work don't look at people just within an adult context or within a mental health context. Look at people in their holistic sense and across the age range. So for a fragmentation of social work, and I say this with a caveat that we have not concluded our kind of submissions around consultations, but there's potential for the fragmentation of the social work profession and dilution. So when we're talking about National Social Work Agency earlier, Is there a conflict there? I can't fully answer that now, but potentially there could be as a profession. So, and it is about holding people at the heart, and that's what the social work profession does. And whether that's within a local authority, and I understand that there's a much wider issue there in terms of local authority, National Care Service, etc., which I won't kind of open up right now. So in terms of there's a fragmentation of a profession that holds people in their holistic sense, as opposed to just as a part. So to have bits here and bits there, would we lose a sense of the profession and the way that it works with people across the piece? And I'd just like to kind of reinforce that point about transitions for children and transitions for adults into older people's services, which is, I don't know, you turn into an adult, you turn into an older person stroke of midnight on your 65th birthday. So there's definitely, in terms of NCS, hopefully finding a way to plug those gaps would be helpful.
Thank you. Stephanie, you had a quick question?
Yep, quick question if I could direct it to you, Suzanne, there. So I also sit in the Education Committee, so we're kind of looking at this stuff just now as well. And certainly we heard about, you know, situations where you've got a family who have got a justice social worker, who've got an addiction social worker, who have a children's social worker, and about the fact that, you know, actually these different social workers are focused on different information, and then there's the kind of job of actually pulling all of those threads back together again to look at the whole family holistically. So I'm wondering if this presents an opportunity to, I'm going to say streamline, but I don't mean streamline. I suppose I mean take a much more holistic approach where you perhaps have social workers who are working with the whole family. So rather than have three or four social workers, that you've got one or two who are kind of looking at things in the round and applying their expertise and their knowledge right across it. I don't know if that's the case, or if, you know, there's very specific training to each of those strands, that means that they would still all need to kind of be separate. So just interested in what you would say around that.
In terms of social work, social workers are trained in all of the kind of the disciplines from university, graduate, and will have had experience, certainly academically and most often practically, in each of the areas, children, young people, criminal justice and adults. In terms of what's, I suppose I'd refer back to my earlier kind of response around social work and the evolution of social work, which has been submitted to this committee by other social work specific agencies, as well as the Mental Welfare Commission, around the shift of social work away from the gatekeepers of budgets, eligibility criteria, the implementation of self-directed support, which has got to be one of the best pieces of legislation ever. And I suppose just as an aside, in thinking about the implementation gap and the shift in cultures, that's key. We can have the best NCS bill in the world with everybody's input, but if we don't have the implementation gap sorted along with the shifting cultures, then we'll end up in the kind of same place. And hopefully NCS will help to kind of push that forward in terms of self-directed support. But back to your question, I would say that hopefully with the introduction of a national social work agency, of depending on the outcome of the various consultations, that social work would be permitted to actually operate within its founding principles, knowledge, skills and values, and work with people in the holistic sense, in communities and as individuals, across whatever the diagnosis or age.
Thank you. Okay. We must move on to... Sorry, apologies. Rosemary wants you to come in. I keep on doing that to you, Rosemary. I do apologise.
Right. I need a flag.
You need a flag, yeah.
I just want to pick up on a couple of the things about structures and working together. There is a risk in any structure. There will be one that has positives in one sense, one that has positives in another. And it might be helpful to think of the legislation, echoing something you said, Suzanne, about enabling. And if we go right back to the user experience, it's about making it seamless at the point of delivery. It doesn't necessarily mean one organisation does everything, but what's in the legislation has to enable it and reduce the barriers. And I think even within the current
delivery system, the current regulatory system, there are probably things that can be done, such as better information sharing, more enabling of working together, that if picked up well, would reduce some of the risk of perception of barriers at the point of delivery. But they all have to be equally well-resourced, I would add.
Thank you. We need to move on to talk about Anne's Law and the advocacy around that. Emma, over to you.
Thanks, Convener. Yeah, just a few questions about Anne's Law. We know that one of the main drivers of introducing Anne's Law was a recognition that families and friends were absolutely essential during the pandemic, you know, to support health and well-being of residents in care homes. And so, and we know that this might be a question for Suzanne, actually, because of the whole health and well-being aspects of the introduction of Anne's Law. And it's about visits to or by care home residents. So it doesn't mean everybody goes in, it means they actually can go out as well. So I'm just interested to hear your thoughts on whether the aspects in the bill about visits to or by care home residents is adequate in order to meet the needs of what are to support the well-being of our residents.
And throughout COVID pandemic, the Commission was inundated with concerns from families around the impact of of visits in care homes, or indeed no visits. The Commission's view: everybody obviously has a right to family, private and family life, which include visits, whether a care home is somebody's home once they kind of get to that stage. We fully support Anne's Law, both the visits in and out of the care home. Otherwise, if we're talking about, if we don't have visits out of the care home, then we're talking about detention, essentially, which is a whole other ball game. We'd also suggest that should, for any reason, that the NCS bill is paused or delayed, that Anne's Law should be included in any relevant legislation in order to avoid any delay to this. We see this is fundamental for upholding people's rights and ensuring that people have the right to their family life.
And now, and in the terms of advocacy and complaints, we've talked a little bit about it already. So, is the bill adequate to be able to deal with that kind of support if there are any issues around if somebody? I suppose if we need to look at who's responsible, who's accountable. I know that there's issues around the legal liability insurance. That was one of the issues that had come up. And, you know, it was a real challenge during lockdown about how care homes were really protecting not only one resident, but all residents, for example. Is that something that needs to be further considered?
Refer you to Kevin as the care home regulator. I think he'd be best placed to answer that.
Yeah, I mean, basically, I wouldn't disagree with what's been said up to now by colleagues. I mean, this fundamentally goes back to what we talked about earlier: people, and certainly connecting with people is a fundamental right and essential for well-being and good mental health. I think it's fair to say that the pandemic highlighted the need for a stronger voice for people experiencing care in their families, and notwithstanding what's proposed in the bill, the government has already published two new health and social care standards, which I'm sure you're aware of, to put Anne's Law effectively into practical effect while the legislation is being prepared and considered. We're in no doubt that even the two standards as they are enable care homes to build on existing good practice, supporting meaningful contact. We know there is a balance, a difficult balance sometimes to make between people's rights and choices and the risk to others. But I think the standards give that balance, and the legislation seeks to enshrine that in law in terms of giving ministers power to require providers of care homes to comply with any directions they make, particularly if there were something as serious as the pandemic again. And those would take account, no doubt, of public health requirements as well. So on balance, we're supportive of the work. I think the bill proposes to embed Open with Care, and we think it's absolutely crucial for those visits to be regarded as not just visits into the care home but out of the care home, because people in care homes are part of communities and the care homes are in communities, and it was pleasing to see referred to in Feely and I think elsewhere the investment that should be regarded as investment in communities. So again, in terms of advocacy, we think, and the Charter indeed will also give people confidence in their rights, and of course as the regulator we have a role, and we've already been given a role, whether that's pursuing through our existing complaints function or through other means, we will follow up as always to make sure that those rights and compliance with the new standards, and if the legislation is passed eventually, the legislation are upheld.
Question about should Anne's law be extended to other facilities like hospitals, for instance? And I understand like infection control and prevention guidance is really important in specific areas, especially if there's other outbreaks in other places. So is that something that that you've considered, that whether we should extend it to hospitals?
I'll probably defer to my colleagues, because I think whilst there are similarities, and you're right to highlight, infection prevention and control is as important in care homes as it is in hospitals. But again, we've got to be careful that a care home is different. It's not a clinical environment and it is somebody's home. So there is a risk that, you know, if we do it the other way around, we potentially could over-medicalise a care setting. But in terms of whether that would be appropriate for a hospital setting, I'd probably defer to my colleague in Healthcare Improvement Scotland.
Thanks, Kevin. So, yeah, as you said, there's obviously a range of important considerations around infection prevention control, particularly within acute hospital environments, and particularly where there may be some people who are very vulnerable and immunocompromised. And NHS services have had to continue at various points throughout the pandemic to kind of make adjustments to visiting to take account of some of those considerations. For example, if there's been an outbreak in a particular ward and looking to kind of restrict visiting in order to help to contain that outbreak. However, again, very much recognising the importance of people being able to have contact with family and friends, and the real, the really vitally important role that plays in terms of somebody's overall health and wellbeing, and indeed their recovery, particularly if somebody is having to be within hospital for a period of time. A lot of work has been done. Our Community Engagement Directorate led a lot of work with health boards during the pandemic around virtual visiting and some of the technology and the support and the guidance to enable that to happen, so that patients were still able to have contact with their loved ones if it wasn't possible to have that face-to-face contact. And that was both around the kind of actually getting the technology and the hardware needed to support it, but again around the kind of general principles and embedding that ethos of supporting people to maintain that vital contact with family and friends.
Thank you. Thanks.
We should be finishing in about a couple of minutes, but if with everyone's permission, I'm going to extend it by about 10 minutes because we still have got one area of questioning to go. So if I could go to Evelyn Tweed on monitoring of the National Care System.
Thanks, Convener. I've rolled my questions into one large question. I thought we were struggling for time a bit. Good morning. Good afternoon, panel. In evidence, we've heard that 72% of respondents to the National Care Service consultation have agreed that ministers should be accountable for the delivery of social care. Can you give me your views on whether you're in agreement with this approach, what benefits you foresee with this approach, or any risks that you would like to tell us about? And I would like to go to Suzanne first, and then anyone else who would like to come in.
Thank you. So in terms of the monitoring and the oversight of NCS, we need to establish agreed measures to monitor. We set out in our submission that the principles of the bill are too broad, as are on the face of it, appears that the ministerial kind of powers held within there as well, albeit we're it's only at the first stage. And the principles therein are too broad to measure meaningfully. So in terms of what that would look like in reality, I don't think you could actually come up with anything tangible. We would support and expect parliamentary scrutiny and reporting of the monitoring by the ministers to Parliament. The Commission has got a statutory monitoring function under the Mental Health Act, and we also monitor reports around adults with incapacity and children and young people. And we're more than happy to discuss our kind of experience of monitoring in the mental health context once the reviews are concluded. And I think it's important to note, in terms of ministerial accountability, etc., and that what happens with the National Care Service will impact in the implementation of the Scottish Mental Health Law Review. In terms, you're looking at ministers and you're looking at oversight and that monitoring responsibility. It's really important that these are joined up. Would suggest a National Care Service oversight group, perhaps responsible for the oversight of delivery. We talk about implementation gap, we talk about shifting cultures. Is there something here for a body that oversees and is and it's collaborative and cohesiveness that's needed to deliver? We know that there is public health data available for monitoring, Scottish ministers accessing that. Health boards have needs assessments, data is available in communities and localities. So in terms of the ministers having accountability and access to data, so this, I suppose what I'm trying to say is it's very complex in terms of the various different strands. So in terms of, as I say, I would expect the parliamentary scrutiny overall of the monitoring by Scottish ministers having responsibility, but their powers, etc., need to be really clarified within the bill.
For views on that question?
What Suzanne said. I think as well, you'd asked about agreement, benefits, risks. It is difficult to comment because there isn't a huge amount of detail. But I think one of the things that, in addition, that occurs to us is that monitoring, scrutiny and regulation are very closely joined. There's a lot of similarity between them. And we've already engaged with Dame Sue Bruce on her current review. And I think there is a lot of argument to be said for what she finds and comes out of her review, because scrutiny, monitoring and oversight, they're slightly different things. So from an SPSO point of view, we monitor complaints handling and we monitor the outcome of complaints handling, but it's unclear how that might apply in relation to the powers under Section 15 to transfer services. So I think in a different way, I'm probably saying the same thing, that there needs to be clarity about ministers' role within the bill, and that will probably help and inform and enable an appropriate accountability structure once that is clearer. But at the moment, I don't really have a lot of detail.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. To be honest, we're not entirely clear what was meant by monitoring the National Care Service, and probably suspect that's multifaceted, as suggested by colleagues. But clearly, if services are directly provided or commissioned by the National Care Service, presumably that will require to be inspected and or regulated. It's difficult for us to provide detail on any changes that might be required, but again, one of the reasons we welcomed Sue Bruce's involvement and Dame Sue Bruce in terms of her review was that is geared, we think, to providing some sort of sense of that. All I would say in terms of our own approach is that, you know, to reiterate the strong track record that we've got of working across complex structures and being flexible and responsive to a changing landscape, and feel well placed to do that irrespective of the structures that are put in place. And similarly, I think, you know, we've alluded to Dame Sue Bruce's inquiry a number of times today. I think what is equally helpful, perhaps, is the recent announcement by the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care of a review of mental health scrutiny and assurance, which will feed into that work of Dame Sue Bruce and indeed the wider scrutiny and regulation to inform the National Care Service development. So we welcome that. So again, the only one other thing that remained unclear for us was in relation to Section 3 of the bill, and that was responsibility for improvement support. And it said that ministers will put in place and keep in place arrangements for the purpose of monitoring and improving the quality of services that the National Care Service provides. It's not clear to us what that impact would be on our own role in that respect. I've hopefully outlined how we link improvement support, both targeted and generic, to our scrutiny findings, and we would certainly welcome further discussions around that. But certainly we feel that we would be able to be flexible and responsive, as we have been previously, irrespective of what the structures that are put in place and what those structures provide for.
I think really just to echo what colleagues have said and support all of the points that have been made, I think from our perspective it comes back to that kind of clarity of roles and responsibilities, being very cognisant, as Rosemary has said, of the interplay between the monitoring, scrutiny and regulatory activities and the various parts that they all have to play. And I think really that clear transparency and accountability, I'm focused on the kind of impact and outcomes in terms of quality of care that people are receiving will be the key consideration in terms of any of that oversight. And like Kevin, again, we're keen to continue to play our full part from both our assurance and our improvement functions and supporting the considerations move forward.
Thank you. And a final question from Tess White. Tess.
Thank you. Sorry for being late this morning. I was at another committee. Thank you, convener. So my question, I have one question, if I could address it to Rosemary and Kevin, please. So many are concerned that the bill for an NCS gives too much power, centralised power to ministers. And we've heard today it makes the ombudsman function toothless, powerless, and as Rosemary said, can't do its job. So my question is, what other conflicts of interest do you foresee? Thank you.
What a good question. Thank you. I think fundamentally it's partly, I believe, to do with the drafting of the bill. And I know this might seem a bit left of field, but I want to go back to the thing of co-design. And I've been reflecting on a really positive co-design experience that we had where we were working with the Scottish Government. And that was in relation to the establishment of the Independent National Whistleblowing Officer function. And we worked closely with the government, who led and hosted events for a whole range of stakeholders. But concurrently with that, the legislation was being developed and drafted. So there was an outline framework of the legislation, but what it meant was by the time the legislation was drafted, it was informed by the co-design, but also it worked the other way and they informed each other. And there were huge benefits to this because it meant by the time the legislation came for parliamentary scrutiny, there was a very real example in the whistleblowing standards of what that might look like in practice. And one of the concerns I have at the moment is the timing of the co-design and the drafting of legislation. And I think we're in danger of losing the benefit of the two happening concurrently if one happens ahead of the other. Now, that, I think, will then inform partly whether, as drafted, the powers of ministers, and I suppose we're thinking about Section 15 in particular, are what was intended, or whether those powers have been put in place to try and
take on board anything that comes out of the co-design later, and that's not clear at the moment. Now, I don't feel it appropriate as an apolitical body to say anything about whether ministers have too much power or not. That, I think, is for Parliament to decide. But I do think that, as drafted, there is inconsistency about where powers sit and how they interact with each other. And if I'm going to be taking the complaints focus on this, I don't want to appear like I'm being negative about what it might mean for the SPSO. This is fundamentally about, we have created in Scotland an internationally respected ombudsman service. We're recognised as being, you know, as public service, as ombudsman, as being innovative. We do a lot of good work, and I think it would be a retrograde step to undo any of that if we could draft legislation that enables the two to sit side by side coherently. And at the moment, I'm not sure they do.
Come in, I think. Did anyone else want to come in? No, just Kevin then.
There's nothing much I can really add to that, I don't think. As I said earlier today, we recognise it's a framework bill, and as such, the detail that all of us would like to hear more about will come later through consultation, co-design and discussions with officials, no doubt. So again, I don't see any conflict for us as the independent regulator at the moment. Yes, we may have a role if this comes to pass in inspecting and regulating services that are commissioned by the National Care Service and thereby government. But again, I suppose that would be similar to that commissioned by the NHS, or akin to the NHS. So again, why I suppose we welcomed the emphasis and the strong emphasis on independent scrutiny by an independent scrutiny body such as ourselves. The only one I'm aware, you know, there's been discussions about intervention orders, and I understand there's been some concern expressed about possible overlap between the framework bill in relation to ministerial intervention, the care inspectorate's enforcement powers. To be honest, we welcome the strengthening of our enforcement powers, and it might be wise to look more closely at this as more detail emerges, but my initial thoughts are that we had something similar in terms of emergency powers during the pandemic, and we were able to manage and work through those. So again, I suppose the recurring theme and probably what I've said today is careful consideration as the detail emerges to identify any issues that of that nature that may arise. But we remain recognising the potential benefits, and again, are happy to support, you know, in any way we can, if it's through our existing approaches or indeed through Sue Bruce's work or the Independent Review of Mental Health.
Thank you very much, and thank you to the panel and my colleagues for everything this morning. At our next meeting,
I wondered if I might bring something up with the committee.
Is it in relation to this?
It's in relation panel? To work within the committee. So I wonder, do you want to?
Well, can we have? We're going to have a discussion in private afterwards.
Well, I'd quite like to do something now, okay, if that was possible. Thank you. Sorry for interrupting. You know, given we're currently engaged in the National Care Service scrutiny, I thought the reports yesterday around the two-tier National Health Service were quite alarming, and I thought that perhaps I would like to seek the advice of the committee on whether they thought we should be clarifying some of that, as it very much links in with the work that we're doing. So it was really just to seek some clarity from the committee on that.
Thank you, Carol. That is something that we can discuss in private, because it relates to our work programme, and it rather than in public today, but particularly since I didn't have advance notice of what you were going to say. That would have been helpful. So I am going to suspend. We're going to go into a private session where we can have detailed discussions on what we've heard today and any other issues that members want to bring up. But that concludes the public section of our meeting today.